Well, hello, everybody. This is going to be a different kind of show than we normally do because it's there's adult drinking involved this evening, which is a novelty for us. So this is our first NAAFI Natters show where we're being a little bit more irreverent and we're going to talk about, well, crappy war films. You all have read it all in the description below. So that's what we're going to talk about. We're missing one participant at the moment. That's not bad. I expect he'll turn up later. That's our American friend, Chaz. But joining us, we have a real group of disparate individuals. So I don't know where they're going to appear on your screens, but we have Matt Bone, a Canadian, who's a film fan and typhoon expert in Sussex. We've got Duncan Hollands. Those who've been following my shows know Duncan, the cameraman, ex-guards, tour guide. We have Dr. Philip Blood calling in from Arkham, historian, author, all that, generally well-known in history circles. Colin Taylor, about 500 yards away from me, two or three streets across in Bayeux, tour guide, Celtic fan, historian, poet, novelist. My old mate from East Anglia, Neil Lawrence, Italian reenactor, ambulance worker, blah, blah, blah. We spoke for the first time personally, well, on Zoom, in about 20 years yesterday, but we have known each other a long time. We got David Duffy calling in from Ireland, who is the rather curious individual with the green headgear, who runs a circus, legitimately runs a circus. So he is very, very good at looking after clowns. Boom, boom, I'll get that joke. There'll be more clown humor later on, I'm sure. And then the person who's joined us at a ridiculously ungodly hour, which is reminding us of with the clock in the background from Australia, 4 a.m. where you are, Adam.
Good Adam morning, Lunney, everyone.
Our author, our RAF, our Royal Australian Air Force historian and speaker and thing who's been on shows before. So that's our current eight. There is another one possibly joining us later on, we hope. There we are. We're going to talk about generally two nominated films each. So that'll be a film that we really, really despise, a crappy war film. And then another one that is crappy, but we like it. And then we'll be just talking back and forth about them. So who wants to go first? Which one of you wants to go? Who wants to bite the bullet and be the first one to nominate their films?
I nominate Duncan.
Duncan first, okay? First. Someone's got to start.
Yeah, got to start. Cheers.
So we're going to start with Duncan. So your genuinely crap film is? Yeah.
Company of Heroes.
So, and I watched it as well this afternoon, didn't I? So I could join you in the torment. So run through us, basically, and I'll put a couple of images up while you're talking about it, Duncan.
100 minutes. Vinnie Jones, as you can see, what a cracking beret. Okay, Vinnie Jones turns up in the middle of this film. What he's doing there, I honestly don't know, but he wanted fish and chips halfway through it when he talked to a chef. The equipment, no one changes a magazine. It is just ever. I mean, it's just 100 minutes of pure hell. I bought this Blu-ray DVD for €1. I'm looking for the receipt. It's got to go back tomorrow. It's absolutely terrible in every degree.
I mean, for the record, it is supposed to be a Battle of the Bulge film. And when you watch the extras on the show, which I even after the film, I carried on watching the extras. They deliberately, the director, tried to bring in an actor he claimed from every big epic war film. So there's Neil McDonough, Buck Compton from Band of Brothers, Tom Sizemore from Saving Private Ryan. I'm losing the will to live going through the rest of them. But Vinnie Jones from whatever classic war film Vinnie Jones was in. I don't know. That one escapes me. There's Jürgen Prochnow now. He's from Das Boot, of course, is in it.
You promised me boobs in it.
There was boobs. A nude scene. Yeah, it was. Yeah.
I held on. I held on for the boob scene. It was terrible.
Yeah. 100 minutes. So, I mean, have any of other you guys seen Company of Heroes? Is there anyone else who can?
Not even worth wasting the time.
I think you got ripped off at a Euro.
Basically, one of the guys in it was in country for 3 weeks. He became a sniper. Well, it just ran away with itself. It was crazy. And Vinnie Jones turned up in the middle of it. How he turned up in the middle of it.
Just missed drop. It's got airborne wings on Duncan. It was a missed drop.
I mean, it's just truly dreadful because they start in the Elsenberg Ridge in the Ardennes, and then 2 minutes later they're in Stuttgart, and you think, how the hell did they get there? It is just awful. I mean, it has absolutely no redeeming qualities whatsoever, as far as I'm concerned. I mean, and the guy, Neil McDonough, who played Buck Compton, of course, in Band of Brothers, he looks just embarrassed. He's only in it for like 2 minutes at the beginning and 1 minute at the end. And he gives this look of, this isn't anywhere near as good as Band of Brothers. And, you know, he probably was sold it as being nearly as good as Band of Brothers and turned up on set and realized, oh, no. But, you know, it is what it is. So, yeah, Company of Heroes is, for anyone watching this, it is an absolute, complete, stinking turd. There's no other thing to way to describe it. It is,
but if anybody wants to watch it, I know somebody who's got one for sale.
Yeah, I mean, let's just show that image again of Vinnie Jones's beret. I mean, I'm using the word beret in the absolute loosely connotation there, because it is, I can't find my image now. I think I might have deleted it deliberately. My computer rejected it, I think, possibly. I can't find it now, but it is just genuinely awful. And, you know, there was obviously no military advisor on set, and it's just absolutely dreadful. So looks like Chaz has joined us. So we've got Chaz in there. So that's all very exciting. So the Americans are late for World War II. I mean, he's done this deliberately, isn't he? Clearly to make the best of the joke, you know.
And World War One too. And
yeah, so here we are. So
and I'm late. He still looks better than all the rest of
us. You're called Bella, which is your daughter's name. So I'm
changing. Yeah, I was. She had her first diagnostic test, and she was very nervous. And I held her hand, and I fed her some answers. And I shouldn't have done that. That's unethical. But there you are. Hello.
Well, hello, Chaz. You know, I'll make no more coming late to the war jokes, because we'll be insulting you. You know, because Adam the Australian is now glad there's someone else who can take the slack up of being, you know, being the subject of the butt of everybody's humours, apart from our Irish contingent, of course, and the English. We can all just insult each other anyway. So we have just done Company of Heroes, which is an absolute piece of complete and utter steaming crap. So, but your crap film that's good, Duncan, let's run through your crap film that's actually good.
You want my good film?
Yeah.
You want my good film?
Yeah.
Age of Heroes.
Yeah.
Absolutely superb. I love it. It is a Sean Bean, Danny Dyer, you know, Dunkirk gets back to England, insubordinate, ends up in the clink, gets remission, gets out, wants to become a commando, goes to Norway. Absolutely superb, superb film. I know you're going to rip it apart with the webbing and everything else like that, but it is a real British film. I absolutely love this film. I've watched it several times and I thoroughly recommend it.
Well, I think you're on your own with that one, Duncan, to be honest.
Come on, boys. Come on. That's a British, that's a real film.
Yeah, I'll show a couple of images.
About so half an hour.
While you're defending it, and Neil Lawrence has done some wearing a British Army kit like I have in the past, and you've worn it for real. There's this shot of them going across the fjords there in their excellent snow camouflage that they presumably couldn't get out of stores.
Yeah, but it's a good British film. Come on, the stories there.
Let's look at the webbing here, right? Just, I know it's a bit, A, it's all different colours, right? They're wearing two belts. Where's his cross strap set up, Danny Dart? The wide bit starts on his back, for goodness sake. I mean, it's just, I mean, has anyone got anything they can possibly say good about Age of Heroes?
There was a woman in it.
I can understand why Danny Dyer's webbing is like that.
Right.
I know exactly why, because I have the same problem. You have to put it so that it goes either side of your breasts.
Wait, can you say breasts on the show?
Yeah, he's just said breasts. We can say breasts, we can say boobs, all that's possible, yeah.
It's either in, you know what, it's either in or out, lads.
I don't think Danny Dyer being slightly overweight is the issue. I don't think he is in the movie. Is he overweight? I don't think he is.
No, he's not overweight. Listen, don't knock it. I'm defending it. It was a great, great film. Come on, it's a real adventure film.
Okay, come so we're
what medication were you on when you were watching
which
it?
Other
Duncan?
Classic film does it completely rip off? The Sergeant Major rips off which other film? Oh, come on, guys! You, well, you have to. Well, the sergeant major, an age of heroes, goes, come on, he meets the guys. He said, and some of you already know me and some of you don't, and those who haven't are in for an infinitely big surprise, and let's start for our first heart attack, shall we? It's all just direct from Wild Geese. The script, he just takes the same lines away.
No, it's a, come on, it's a good, it's Sean, it's Danny Dyer. Come on.
Oh, Jack, I gave up because of Danny Dyer. I couldn't stand that bloody accent of his.
Yeah, he is. He does do the Cockney thing a bit too much, doesn't he? I mean, it's...
And during the commando training, he started begging one of the officers to be, you know, oh, don't kick me out, let me stay. I thought, right, that's enough. I've had enough of you, and turned it off. I didn't even bother watching.
You didn't even persist with it, Adam. You just...
No.
Yeah, no.
See you later. Guys, I'm disappointed. It's a good film. It's a good, good film.
The thing is, though,
the Germans played well. What year was that? I'm sorry to interrupt.
2011 it was.
It purports
to be the genuine history of the formation of 30 Assault Unit Commandos, which of course isn't, because their first operation was Dieppe in 42, and this is set I don't know when it's set. I don't know what it's... But
I think the people who wrote it didn't know when it was set.
I think that's a very good point. I think they had no idea. I think it's... Yeah.
Anyway, Danny Dyer is a real tit in that movie all the way through. So
I think he's just a real tit, isn't he? I don't think you need to add in that movie. I think Danny Dyer is just a tit, isn't he? If you're watching, Danny, I'm sure you're lovely, really, but, you know.
Paul would love to have you on the show at some point.
Yeah, we have you on the show and defend Age of Heroes with Duncan. If you
stay away from the camera, Danny Dyer does not have that accent and is really a nice, quite shy bloke.
Yeah, I heard he's actually Etonian. Yeah, he's...
He's not an old Etonian, but...
His real name is Rafe.
Yeah.
So Duncan, I don't think you've managed to convince us that Age of Heroes is anything other than what it is. It's just...
No, Duncan. In fairness, Duncan, I've got a mate here. I've got a mate here who was really impressed with your presentation.
Really?
Yeah.
You've actually bought a penguin. Now, for those watching, this is a somewhat in joke between a group of us that I'm not even going to explain. It's just
classy.
I like the randomness of it.
Yeah, we're not going to attempt to be any way serious tonight. So yeah.
I like that, David.
The viewer numbers are dropping like stones, by the way. People have started it going, is this it? Is this really what it's going to be? No, actually, we're doing quite well. We've got quite a lot of people watching it, bizarrely. Obviously, got nothing better to do on a Friday night. So,
a big dog.
Right, so we're
all the serious content on this channel, and we put this on, and you get good views.
Well, you know, you've got to try something, haven't you, really? So that was Duncan's movies there. So who wants to go next with their
Oh, I'll go next.
David. Okay.
Oh, no. Come on.
So which one do you want first, Paul?
You want your absolute steaming pile of turd first.
Okay. Well, it's a no-brainer. It's called D-Day Assassins.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. D-Day Assassins.
I'm going to put a still up, and let's just take in all that is wonderful about this still. Right, let's...
All right, okay.
I mean, it's just, you know, what can you say? I mean,
What is that gun?
He's got a Winchester.
He's got a Winchester, sure. Yeah.
That's him, Gavin.
And there's this one.
He's got David's hat.
Jesus.
I mean,
man.
He doesn't know if he's the cowboy or the Indians.
I mean, again.
It's brutal. I mean, you see in the first photograph, I mean, the guy's even got an All-American patch on his, an 82nd patch. On his arm, you know, the one guy has a Winchester. Like, where he ever got that from is amazing. And even when he's firing us, he doesn't have to use the thing. You know, one guy's got a Lee Enfield. Another guy's got a single bore shotgun. I mean, I don't know. Has anybody else seen it?
I have seen it, David. Yeah,
I will.
For research purposes, I'm going to. Seen it. Yeah.
Yeah.
I like to have scotch and watch these really bad films. And just, like,
I mean, the thing is, again, the thing that's annoying about these films is me, the host, is they always purport to give a kind of a level of historical credence behind it, because it says purporting to be the true story of the Filthy 13, the demolitions company, the 506th of the 101st Airborne. And I knew some of those guys. I met Jack Agnew and Jake McNeese and these guys, and some of the characters in this film are actually named after these guys, and these guys genuinely did drop into Normandy. Jack Agnew is the pathfinder who genuinely set up the beacon in Baston on the brick pile you see in the photos there. And this movie is basically going to their graves and shitting on it, in my opinion. I mean, it is awful. It is just, and it was clearly filmed in someone's garden, wasn't it, David? I mean, you can see the kind of trailer in the background that they obviously are keeping the wet armory in, the Winchester and the replica number 4 rifle they have. I mean, it's just...
I mean, that was great.
I mean, you know, we've done the all Eisenhower speech, you know, soldiers, sailors and airmen, you're about to embark on this great crusade. And then it goes into this absolute rubbish. And like, you know, the Germans, I mean, the half a dozen Germans that's in the movie, you know, they've all come out of Inglourious Bastards, you know, they're all dressed in their proper gear. You know, I mean, basically, my summary of it was, is that if they could have found a uniform big enough for me to wear, and if Duncan had any knowledge at all about war tactics and maneuvers, then me and him could have been in it.
Yeah.
I've just looked this up. Cost an estimated $1 million to make. Does anyone want to guess how much money it actually took?
It cost a million. It cost a million. What did they spend it on?
It says estimated a million.
I can tell you, I make crappy films for $1 million.
No, you make very artistic, wonderful films, Chaz.
You know, mine are all people-to-people film, you know, independent films. And with $1 million, that's absolutely... low of the lowest of the lowest rung in independent filmmaking.
Right.
Honestly.
It took seven grand worldwide.
7,000.
Wow. Actually, there's a very interesting piece though on the director. I think a guy called Andrew Jones. Right. I think so. I've got like there's a really interesting thing about him. He was born in 1983 and he's 5'11".
Right.
That's it.
Okay. Yeah. But the thing is, David, because you had D-Day assassins, I'm giving you a bonus because we have to mention D-Day Dog Company as well, the pointy hawk one, because to me, they are cut from the same cloth. And I'm going to just share an image of this, I'm using the word movie in its loosest. I'm going to try and find him. I've got lost the image now. Hang on. Where's it gone? Oh, here we go. Dog Company. So let's look at this. Let's look at this for a second.
Oh, man.
I mean, why have one belt when two? You can have two. And the guy with the gray, that's pure East German. And one of these gentlemen, I don't know which, is Nicolas Cage's son, apparently. I think it might be him. And I think genuinely... And for those who are watching this, who understand history, who follow my job, I think this guy is genuinely supposed to be Colonel Rudder, James Rudder, on D-Day at Pointy Hawk. I genuinely think that's who he's supposed to be.
Well, he wouldn't have his colonel insignia on the front of his helmet.
I think that's the least of its problem. And there's another one there. There is Pointy Hawk recreated for the movie.
Right here.
I mean,
you don't know which one is the German.
Yeah, they put. I mean, Neil, what's that helmet there? That's not a German helmet, is it? Or is it?
It's kind of looks like German in style.
It's German in style, yeah. That's the best we can say for it. And by the way, all the trailers of these movies are in the description of this show, so you can go back and watch the trailers. And if you're brave enough, you can actually watch the full movie if you feel like it. I mean. But these are genuinely movies that are being made and being released, and people are thinking that people are going to go and watch this stuff, which is Staggering. Well, so
what they do is they sell a DVD for me.
Yeah.
They sell it on platforms, on Hulu and Netflix and stuff like that. You know, and then yeah, the thing is that you make very little money on that. They give you a flat fee, like a renter's fee, say. So they give you like 10, 15, 20 grand, depending on how much you've sold and whom you sold it to. And that's it. That's all the money you see. But if, you know, you're clearly in the red, it's also, some of it is, you know, laundering money too. I mean, it's
all right.
You know,
but you're an independent movie maker, Chaz. So why would you go about trying to do a war epic if you haven't got any money? I mean, surely if you've got no money, you do something set in a diner between two people talking.
Yeah,
surely,
I mean, that's also a lot more interesting than rehashing these memes that mean nothing. You know, other people have done it better. You know, the Cockney non-com. I mean, how can you... Zulu, that's it. I mean, that's all I need to see in my life. That's that... what's his name? The actor.
James Booth.
Oh,
Henry Hook. God. Yeah, James.
God. That was wonder. I mean, that's I watch that monthly. You know.
I think we should have a kind of forfeit for tonight. Anyone mentioning a genuinely decent war film. I think anybody.
Okay.
You've now mentioned Zulu now, so I think you're now being punished now, because anyone who mentions a genuine proper classic, there's a fine to pay. In fact, your fine is you've got to pay to download and watch D-Day Assassins now. That's my rule. So anybody who mentions a genuinely brilliant film, and I don't mean ironically brilliant, I mean we all know the ones we're thinking of,
Don't say it.
I won't say it. The one with Alec Guinness and railways and stuff, kind of thing. Yeah. You know, if we mention that kind of thing, that's it. You've got to download one of these films and watch it.
I don't particularly like that film, by the way.
Well, that will come up later in Philip's choice.
Alex Guinness and the Railways. I didn't particularly like it.
I just can't get over how old Bill Holden looks in that railway movie.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think Phil wants to say something. He's being very polite. He's overawed by our weirdness.
If I mention the name of the film that I think is crappy, it's very close to the film that you think is very good.
Yeah, we'll do that later. Yeah.
Will I get sanctioned?
No, you'll be fine for that. You
probably,
because it will. That's a legitimate reason to mention it, because we're mentioning the sequel. So, you know, but I think.
But it's not the sequel. They say it's not.
They say it's not, but clearly it's trying to cash in. It's trying to bring you in under slightly false pretend. But we'll come to that later.
And it is genuinely crap.
Yeah. So David, you've got to bring your crap but good film now. We've done your crap but crap ones. Now we want to have your crap but actually good.
Right. So I don't know if this disappoints some of you, but it's the epic Battle of the Bulge.
No.
It upsets me.
I'll put some stills up. So there we have.
We all know the story of the Battle of the Bulge. Obviously,
unfortunately, the script writers didn't.
Come on, Colin, I was building to that.
Sorry, David. Sorry.
Christ.
You're the ringmaster, David. Whip us into control. Come on. You're used to dealing with people. Come on.
I know, yeah. So, as I said, thank you, Colin. So, for obvious reasons, I mean, it's not exactly historically correct.
Spain.
You can obviously see that's certainly the Ardennes. I would have thought that's the German attack on Noville. Yeah, absolutely. I've been to Noville, so that's definitely what Noville looks like in December.
I'm sorry, but I don't mean to insult anyone. Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, like, there's great actors in it, but why?
Oh, we've lost David a second, have we?
Someone's gone.
David's dropped out. His own internet connection has dropped him for for dishing Battle of the Bulge. He'll come back, I'm sure.
That was two shit films. Seriously.
No, but you see, I'm gonna confess that if Battle of the Bulge comes on, I'll end up watching it.
Yeah, but it's the only film with its own intermission, so you could sneak out the bloody movie together.
That is true.
No.
I can see a bad film if I have good booze.
That's true. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, is there anyone here who can, you know, put any kind of can I, you know, Ben, any good thing to say about Battle of the Bulge? I mean, it's entertaining, isn't it? I mean, yeah, no?
Yeah, I like to sing along with the Germans.
But the singer, they only sing one verse, don't they? They just repeat the same chorus or verse again and again.
Gives you a chance to learn it.
I have something nice to say. Robert Shaw's haircut reminds me of Battle of Britain. And, you know, that makes me happier.
But he was also...
Whoa, forfeit!
Yeah, you've just said Battle of Britain, yeah, forfeit. Film. Yep.
But he was also Custer, all the three at the same time.
Yeah, and Red Grant in From Russia with Love, which is not a war film, so that's not a forfeit.
Okay.
And it's my show, and it's my rules. But, I mean, I forget which one of them I was talking to, but one of you said that Charles Bronson was good in the Battle of the Bulge. Who said that? One of you did.
No.
Someone did. Someone I was talking to said Charles Bronson was good.
That was me down the pub.
Okay, were you drunk when you said that?
Can I do my Charles Bronson bit from Battle of the Bulge?
Yeah. Do your Charles Bronson bit. Go on, hang on. I'll put you on spotlight. Hang
Crossroads, on. Yeah, when they've moved the sign, you know? Yep. Like, and Colonel Kiley, or Keeley, right, okay? Henry Fonda. Did anybody actually see the bridge, the old bridge blown? And, okay, here it is. This is Charles Bronson. Yeah, the last one's over. They were just about to blow it when we crossed, and hey, what the heck? They weren't engineers, they were MPs. Any good?
You should be entertainment, David. That's
hey, what the heck?
You're right. Now you're saying it, I do remember that bit, yeah.
So
who do you play? Improves on it.
He played a non-com or something?
Yeah, he played a sergeant. Oh, no, he was... Was he a lieutenant or captain, wasn't he?
No, he used to be. He got busted down for hitting somebody of higher rank.
That's in that other film that we can't mention.
Is it? It's in The Bulge as well.
No, he was an officer in The Bulge. The other one with Lee Marvin is where he was busted of hitting an officer.
Oh, right.
It's very correct. Yes, yeah. And all the sequels to that, by the way.
I think we're getting confused because Charles Bronson didn't have, shall we say, the greatest range as an actor. So he tended to just play the same character, didn't he, really?
Yeah.
Well, he was... What was that movie, that dystopian movie that took place in New York during the 70s? What was that? That was a good film. He was good in that.
The one where the... Gang kills his wife when he goes and hunts them out.
Death Wish.
That's it.
Death Wish.
The first one got a bit steamy by Death Wish 2.
The first one was okay.
The first one was good.
Yeah.
Yes, good. Very good. Very good. And
directed by Michael Winner, who is directing one of the films that's coming up later.
Winner's Dinners.
I thought he was really good. Like Spanish, a time in the West. He didn't have to do anything, just stand there, and they just kept putting camera at him, and he just sort of looked into the camera.
Yeah. Yeah. So Did Eisenhower
come out of retirement?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah. Eisenhower legitimately came out of retirement just to say how shit Battle of the Bulge was. I mean, it was like, you know.
And Battle of the Bulge is just part of that Cold War rhetoric, you know, that all you need one American is equal to 100 Krauts, you know, it's and 1,000 Soviets, you know, I mean, it's part of the Pax Americana, you know, bullshit that propagates the worst things about my country, I have to say, you know, Shaw saying, now you motivated broken men to fight to the last draw, you know, when after Malmedy, you know,
was he Welsh? I don't remember him being
my bad German, be a Welsh.
No, but
I don't know. I
but
I'm offended by shit like that.
To be devil's advocate for Battle of the Bulge, it does kind of highlight some genuine true incidents that happened in the Battle of Bulge. The Malmedy massacre did genuinely occur. Allied intelligence genuinely didn't know there was going to be an attack, or, you know, if that, right. The Germans did have limited fuel. There's elements within it that aren't complete pants. Sure, yeah.
Well, yeah, but you're struggling, really, in a nearly a four-hour film, and you picked out two. No, there's another one.
there's another one in 3 hours.
No, there's another one. There's a reference, obviously, to the siege at Bastogne, you know, yeah, where the Germans come up and they speak to the guys at the checkpoint. And I think for, you know, what is it? I can't remember. Is it the bloody blackguards of Bastogne or something is painted on a sign? Proper thing, yeah, you know. And then it refers back to the general in the HQ, and they mentioned the infamous nuts quote, and that's it.
True. They do.
That's
do that, the whole. They, yeah.
That's Bastogne all in a nutshell. That's it done.
Yeah,
I'd and like it, to see.
Is Bastogne in that? There's one. There's the ruined town where they drag a model Tiger tank through, a truck through, isn't it? Or car? Is it a staff car? There's a vehicle that gets pulled through a really bad model in Battle of the Bulge that, like, just.
Is that not an Ambelev? Is it not? No.
It could be Ambelev, yeah.
Ambelev, where they met the last stand, yeah.
For people who hate it, we know a lot about the movie, don't we?
Because, yeah, bloody, it's
and,
always
and
on
the train set when as well.
No, that, bloody
train
sport.
Set, yes.
Yeah. Those are the types of movie that would play on a Saturday night. Saturday afternoon in local stations, you know, as filler. Yeah. And those are the stuff I grew up on. I mean, that's that model airplanes. You guys had Airflix, we had Revell. And I'd sit there making my models and making believe I was a, you know, a pilot and of a few, and you know, making my Hurricanes and, you know,
all of us here are connected with World War II in some way. We write about it, talk about it, you know, reenact it, whatever. All of us, I'm speaking for all of us, we all wouldn't be where we were if we hadn't watched war films on a Saturday afternoon when we were kids, would we? It's all part of where we ended up. It's watching, and we don't need to list them because I'll pay the forfeits, but we know the ones we're talking about, the Saturday afternoon. For me, as English, after wrestling, before
that's right,
grandstand, it was a war film. Well, you'd flick over to BBC Two, and it would be whatever
Can I throw in my Battle of the Bulge admission here?
Yeah, go on for it.
I don't think they did it here, but where I grew up in Canada, we had all the American stations, and they would edit down movies to make them fit the slot that you had. So the first time I saw the Battle of the Bulge, it was 90 minutes long.
Lucky man.
It was on a Fox channel in Buffalo that we used to get in Toronto. And then I moved here and it came on a Saturday afternoon. I thought, oh, great, that's fine. I was going out to play football or cricket or something. And it just kept going on and on and on. And I'm like, this doesn't seem right. And then the sort of intermission pops up on BBC Two. And you thought, oh, maybe I only saw the first half of it. And so you sit there and you're watching, like, no, it is actually just butchered down to fit whatever little slot they couldn't get for telly.
Oh, what about Australia, Adam? I mean, you obviously got all these movies as well, didn't you? I mean,
absolutely.
So, you know, what's your feeling on Battle of the Bulge?
I remember it being very long, but I only ever watched it once. But it's not something I've ever gone back to.
Well, you have to try it again now. You have to give it another go. It's
only if it is forfeit, Adam.
Yeah. So that's that. Well, I guess we've done David's film. So who wants to go next? Adam, Neil?
I'll go next.
So Neil is going to bring a little bit of kind of seriousness to it, because he's gone for some slightly serious films, because he's very interested in the Italian side of things in World War II with reenactment and collecting. So Neil's going a little bit, you know, highbrow.
If he's going serious, I'm going to go quickly grab another beer.
Get one. For my cigar.
I'll just pop round. Hang on. So, Neil, your films are
my
A steaming pile of shit is Captain Corelli's mandolin.
Yeah.
Now, it's a modern film, but it's depicting a very serious episode that happened on Kefalonia with the massacre of the Italian, or the Acqui Division. But the thing is that, and when you speak to some Italians, they simply call it Hollywood's Mediterraneo. There was a film released in the early 90s.
That was great.
Loads of awards. Mediterraneo. It's a fantastic film. It's a
great film, yeah.
But Captain Corelli's, obviously based off the book by Louis de Benier, depicts, it's just the same old stereotypes of Italian soldiers being sort of lame. And even if you look at it from a historical point of view, if you're looking at it as I do, as someone that's interested in the Italian military, and you look at the equipment and all sorts, there's a lot of confusing things in it. I mean, you've got this soldier who just turns up, rocks up at the camp. You know, he say, "Oh, what's your name? Oh, Carlo. And oh, where were you? You know, I was with the Julia Division." Now he's an artilleryman, and the Julia Division was an Alpine division. Now they had their own artillery. They were autonomous units, and the Julia Division got the Greeks kicked the crap out of them. They managed to fight out, but it's kind of that's the kind of thing that bugs me about it. It just bugs me that in the book, if you read the book, the characters are more fleshed out, but they just pop characters in. The accents of all of them, all trying to do, you know, Nicolas Cage trying to do an Italian accent. You've got John Hurt trying to do a Greek accent. It just ruins it. And you've got Penelope Cruz, who's doing her real accent, and I can't understand a word she's saying in it. It's one of the few films where I use subtitles so I can see what she's trying to say. But apart from that, it does the same old thing. That the battle scene, I hate it. It's the same old thing. The Germans are here. They're going to wipe everyone out. They're amazing. Here are the Germans. They're the best unit. But actually, and it lasts 5 minutes, you know, before the Italians are keel-hauled in, you know. But actually, the battle lasted days. It lasted days, and the Italians actually started the firing first. You know, a few artillery units went, "We're not going to let this happen," and they started popping shells on landing ships. And I think they hit a couple, and I think five Germans were killed. But it, you know, all of a sudden the massacre took place, and there's no real precedent of that. For me, it's a big production, but it's one of those things that you watch. And I'm watching it just to say, that's not correct. That's not correct. It's not one of those films. And it's not really a war film. It's more of a love story with war in it.
Yeah.
But I find that just a tedious watch.
I mean, I can only say I haven't watched it for years. I think I watched it when it came out.
Yeah.
Who else has seen it anytime recently? Anyone else here?
I haven't seen it for a couple of years. And the only reason I watch it when it comes on telly is because it's got Penelope Cruz in it, because she's just fucking stunning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And no, any movie where, I mean, I watched Vicky Cristina Barcelona, which is a stinking pile of rubbish, but it had her in it. And at the end of it, you think, well, that's a couple of hours of my life I won't get back, but at least I got to see Penelope Cruz for a bit.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense. I mean, it's got Christian Bale.
It's a dreadful film.
Yeah.
Do we think that when Hollywood makes a movie about Italians in World War II, and like, there aren't many, they completely understand that most people watching will have no idea what Italian uniforms look like, they'll have no idea what Italian... Yeah. So they don't care. They know that if they make a film like Black Hawk Down, for example, that there are going to be people watching it who served in that era who go, yeah, that badge is wrong.
I think that one of the other things Italians in World War II as well is they're always represented as being crap troops and really bad.
Yeah.
And put the towel in really easy. And you've got all the jokes that do the rounds about Italian forces in World War II. My grandfather said the toughest troops he faced in World War II was the Trienti Division in Africa.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Mm.
They were. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, this kicked up on Twitter, didn't it, last week? And we won't mention which, but it kicked up. A historian made a comment about the Italians being a bit, you know, less than good. And it's that's the cliche, isn't it? The cliche is they're just terrible. And Neil, if we wanted to go do a serious show about the Italians in World War II, I mean, the Allies were incredibly worried about the Italian Navy in 1939, weren't they? That the Italians kicked our ass in the desert for quite a while. So But yeah, when you portray, look at Allo Allo, the British sitcom.
Oh yeah.
The Italian. I mean, the Germans are a joke, but the Italian's an absolute complete pantomime joke, isn't it? I mean, just there's no even attempt to make him anything vaguely. I suppose all of the characters in Allo Allo.
Or in the Home Guard, you guys remember Dad's Army?
No, none of us British ever remember Dad's Army. Says no.
No, I mean that particular
episode. What you're talking about.
That particular episode with the Italian prisoners. I mean, if I were Italian, I think I'd actually. I was verging on kind of like being offensive, because it was a caricature of a caricature. It was like, hey, I do anything. I work for food. I mean, it was like too much. Even vocally, it was like, whoa, tone it down.
But, welcome to 1970s British sitcoms.
Well, ditto here, right?
Soccer ain't our football.
Yeah.
But, you know, I put it to you guys. I mean, they weren't idiots. They knew they were fighting for a schlub. I mean, I would volunteer the first. If I would never fight for Trump. I mean, the first opportunity that I had, I would throw my gun and say, you know, I work for food. You know, I mean, I just. You know, I'm not going to, you know, and I hope I don't have to. But it's.
I don't think they need people like us now. In my early 40s, oh, that's it. They won't need me now. You know, there's no national emergency great enough that they will now need me for. If they do, we're really fucked. You know, it's like, you know, we really need this middle-aged 51-year-old guy living in France to sort us out. Come on. You know, that's. Yeah. So
there's a movie in that. I'm sure someone will give you a million dollars.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's
Captain Crowley's Mandolin. So I mean, and that's the thing, Neil. I was a reenactor. I know my gear, but I don't know Italian gear. I mean, Italian
the reenactor. Gear in it, to be fair to him,
I wouldn't know whether they're right or wrong.
To be fair to him, the uniforms aren't bad. They're not bad. You know, actually, as a matter of fact, a lot of the gear they're using a lot of the web gear is original.
Yeah, because it was for sale. I remember it being for sale at the military at War and Peace afterwards.
Oh, yeah, because movie props had it, didn't it?
Yeah, it had loads of the sets of gear, didn't they? Yeah, I remember.
Yeah, we bought most of it. But, yeah, I mean, the kind of equipment is all sorts. I mean, there's elements in it. You see what look like Alpini troops, but they could be Garda di Finanzia, which is, there was a unit of them sent to Cavone. One of the best parts in it is that you see the Italians dropping paratroops. Now, in April 41, the Italians dropped the Folgore division. A couple of battalions were dropped onto Cefalonia. And that's kind of like the first island captured by paratroops. Although, in all fairness, the Greeks had already like quit, basically signed an armistice. But it's all about the Italians are a bit of a joke. And it's not fair to Italians, really. You know, and the Italians weren't always benevolent occupiers. I mean, they were occupying the country.
Yeah.
And, you know, they're often made out as like, that they're all singing and laughing. And certainly one of the things that happened on Cefalonia prior to the massacre is there was an Italian troop that would sing opera. And he was made to sing opera songs while the Germans executed his comrades.
Wow.
And that kind of thing sort of took place on Cefalonia. But it doesn't really, you know, with this short battle and then the Germans just massacring loads of troops, it doesn't really bring into context that actually the reason the Germans were so pissed with the Italians is because there was combat.
Yeah.
You know, and they weren't the only, I mean, on Corfu, they really did, the Italians dug in. But the reason it's just the fact it's the same stereotype, it's a Hollywood stereotype of Italian soldiers being just laid back, you know. And sure, you can't look at history and say that Italian units were all amazing. Most of them were conscripted. Most of them didn't have an idea or have a clue why they were in the middle of the desert fighting the British. But they had some excellent units, and that's the kind of thing that's kind of washed out. But that brings me on to my second movie.
Yeah.
It's a crap movie, but actually I love it. And that's Attack and Retreat. Now, Attack and Retreat is a 1960s Italian film sponsored heavily by the Russians. So when you watch this film, you are watching communist propaganda, okay? But the thing about it that's amazing is that all the battle scenes were filmed on the original battle sites. And there's an attack on a bridge. And, you know, that's the actual bridge that the Italians actually took. You know, the thing is that there's two versions of it. This is the thing. The release in the West, especially the US and the United Kingdom, and I suspect in Australia as well, they cut scenes from it because it shows the Italians fighting hard, but they're cut from the Anglo-Saxon sphere. They're cut from the movie. But if you watch the original Italian version, Italia Brava Gente, you see the Alpini, and it's all about the attack on the Don. And this, the one thing what I love about it is, one, the gear in it. The gear in it is all original. You know, the machine guns, the lot, you know, some of the, even the vehicles are 10 times better, you know. But the other thing that's really good about it is this, it highlights that actually Italians just weren't fighting, you know, sort of trying to get off with Greek girls all the time.
Yeah.
Or quitting to the British in the desert. It actually shows them on the Russian front. And that's why I like that film. As much as you watch it and you they're also like saying, oh, let's sing the Internationale again. They all go, oh yeah, play that song. It's really catchy. I'll piss off, you know. But it's still good. You know, if you watch it, you're watching pure communist propaganda.
Yeah.
And it's fascinating from that point of view. If you've got, and the acting is well ham, you know, it's all so like heroic looks into the distance. Oh, you know. You know, if only we were fighting for Stalin type thing, and you know, I mean, it's all just from that point of view, it's a pile of crap. But actually, the fact that it highlights Italians fighting on the Eastern Front, they kind of skip over the Italians fighting out of the Don pocket, which, you know, happened. You know, when Stalingrad fell, the Italian Eighth Army was surrounded as well on the Don River near Nikolajevka. But the one thing that many people in the West don't know is that Stalingrad collapsed. Stalingrad was captured, but the Italians decided we're going to get out of this. And the Italians fought their way out. They punched a hole through this pocket.
Good for them.
And you just don't hear about it, do you? It's not one of these, scenarios you hear about, but there's, you know, I can mention this because it's never been made a film, but it should be. And that's the book Sergeant in the Snow. They should make a film about it, and Hollywood should make a film about it, because it's a brilliant piece of literature. I think it used to be compulsory reading in Italian schools. But it describes how they did it and what they did and how they were organized. But that's why I love it. It is crap. It is just pure Soviet propaganda. It's all finance, you know. It's all like, you know, and it's at a time when Italy is also, you know, Italy politically has always been a bit random.
Yeah, random is a word, yeah.
And still is a bit random, you know, but I don't know, I'm living in the UK at the moment, and my God, it's no more random than anywhere. I mean, no, we can't take the mickey out of anyone about our politicians. They're all bloody it. No, even you, Chaz. I mean, you've got nothing on an idiot running this country at the moment, so I won't worry about it, all right?
Yeah, no, I mean, so we're agreeing a film can be crap, but it can be good because it's worthy. It's trying to... The historical setting behind it is worthy of being filmed, but the film itself isn't real. I mean, I've seen it. Have anyone else here seen Attack and Retreat?
No, it's really random. But Peter Falk's in it to give it some sort of Hollywood credence.
I don't think he knows what he's doing, though, does he? I think he was obviously got off a plane, and you know, because he's the only one speaking English, isn't he? Everyone else is speaking all their own native languages.
Yeah.
And he's dubbed in the Italian version, he's into Italian, but yeah. There's Peter Falk there, yeah. The only Columbo mystery he didn't solve.
He's got the Mac on.
He's got the Mac on there, that's where Columbo got it. He got it in this and Russian front, yeah. That solved that mystery.
That's good. That's why it's a crap movie, but it's good because I don't think any of us could think of another film where it shows not just Italians, but the Hungarians or the Romanians or even the Spanish Blue Division. And the Spanish Blue Division actually feature in this film as well, of different units that fought on the Russian front. So from a historical concept, you know, it's great for that. But actually watching it, you really can see how massively communist influence it is, how the Russians are trying to put an influence in. But It's crap, but I love it.
When was it released?
65, I think. 65,
yeah.
There's one author, Italian author, called Curfio Malaparte. And he writes two books that are like the two major, you ask any Italian, it seems like the two, I hate to use that word again, meme, in Italian memory of World War II are the Italians on the Eastern Front that Malaparte was a member of the Eighth Army. And he writes a book called Caput, with reference to the entire campaign. And then he writes another one when he comes back called La Pelle, The Skin, which I have a copy of here. And they're both scandalous books because La Pelle deals with the Allied occupation of Naples, which was exploitative. It was a cesspool.
There's a film 4 Days in Naples, isn't there, about that?
Yeah.
Maybe released in the 40s, I think.
That's right. So it seems like those are the two kind of collective memories of the war in the Italian. I only know this because I did some work in Rome and we were talking about it. I found another World War II geek and we basically spent a week just talking about this, but it's a fucking tragedy, man. They lost 850,000 people. You know, we've lost 200,000 under this. Well, anyway, I promised my wife I wasn't going to talk about politics.
Yeah, well, we knew that wasn't worth a piece of shit. We've all got a bit highbrow there for a while, and I think it's lost its reverence.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Sorry.
Because I'm telling you why. It's because Neil is from East Anglia, and I see East Anglians are incredibly intelligent, are incredibly highbrow, and that's the problem. You know, you can't help elevate things to a higher level.
Well, I've got my professor elbow pads, too.
Nice.
So you've been joining in that bit, Paul?
pretending.
See, so you've got a great hat, Paul. I've got a great hat.
Yeah. I thought about putting this one on for the show. It's my Enemy at the Gates hat that I got off the set, but I'm not.
I've got others.
Anyway, so well, that was some highbrow stuff there about Neil's film. So let's bring it back down to crap again and talk about some really truly crap films. So Who should we go with next? Should we go for Philip wants to go next. So Philip, so your truly crap film, Philip, is
Return from the River Kwai, made in 1989, and it purports to be nothing about the other film.
Yeah,
and. And I got a copy. I never saw this when it first came out. I got a copy from the Daily Mail. They gave out. One of those deals.
That's Takeshi or no.
Yeah. And
George Takei. Yeah. Takei. Yeah.
Yeah. Takei. Yeah. Or Sulu.
Sulu.
So for this program, I put this on. And I was horrified. I really, after 10 minutes, I had to speed forward because it was a particularly awful film, really. And just from every perspective, the Japanese uniforms, the condition of the British and American prisoners of war. Then an American pilot turned up and he started beating up the Japanese soldiers while they're being transported away. I mean, the whole thing's supposed to be based on a book that was about a prison transport from Burma going to Japan. Apparently it was torpedoed and the Allied prisoners of war were all killed. But this film doesn't reflect that. Or from what I saw, it didn't seem to reflect that. It just seemed to be awful. And the only saving grace was Edward Fox, who tried to play a part, and Denham Elliott, who I think we all know from stuff in the past. The rest of it is... I'll be honest, I couldn't watch to the end. It was just, it was just too much for me. It was just awful.
I watched a little bit of it because you picked it, and I'd forgotten that the American who plays the American even existed, because it's Sean Penn's younger brother, Chris. We all remember Chris Penn from and all those other films he was in. I mean, they obviously couldn't afford to get Sean Penn, so they got little brother. And it's just a
I don't think Chris Penn's been called little for many years.
Yeah, no, he's a slightly larger. I mean, again, it's one of those ones that it kind of purports to have some history behind it. There is, as you said, Philip, there is a genuine transport there. Conditions were genuinely harsh in that area. And yet the movie is just silly. And now I can't take George Takei seriously. because he's such an irreverent, outspoken, I can't now take him seriously as a bad guy because I've seen him in so many things like The Simpsons and Family Guy and I can't take him seriously now. Him playing the vicious Japanese just it's comical now. It's just, but Edward Fox is, he's in a couple of the films that come up tonight, and Edward Fox is, I heard someone describe, he's the only guy with a bicep in his face because he's always doing that sort of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's but he can't lift it. He and Denham Elliott can't. And there's an Aussie in it, isn't there, Adam? Who's the Aussie in Return? It's Jack. There's an Aussie in it, Adam. Jack Thompson's in it, yeah.
According to him, he was in the running to play Schindler in that movie.
Right.
I don't know how well that movie would have gone down with him in the lead.
No, but are you saying Eternal River Choir instead of Schindler? Or does the Yeah. Now, Jack Thompson, I haven't seen him in anything, but yeah, Return of the River Choir is just, you know, and it's obviously, although it's claiming, it's not claiming to be based on Bridge and the River Choir, which I'm mentioning in the context that we have to mention, it clearly is just trying to borrow the bit of prestige and fails abysmally. I mean, you can't even buy a DVD of it now. You can find it on YouTube in a kind of bad copy. It's just unremittingly bad. And it's, yeah, there's not. Has anyone got anything they can possibly say to defend Return of the River Kwai?
Well, how's the kid?
No.
There were two astonishing points about this film. It actually made $5 million.
Right. Okay.
Right.
People who got sucked in by the title.
Yeah, probably. Yeah,
I guess. Right. And there was a legal case over the use of River Kwai, which continued into 1998. the whole thing just seemed bizarre, like a Monty Python war film.
I'm going to find out how much it cost to make, because that's where you see.
£7.50, I think. And they had some change. They had enough of the ice creams for the crew. No, I mean, it's a dreadful film.
It's interesting. I just looked it up. It's directed by someone who's going to pop up a little bit later as director of a film in this list.
Who's the director?
It's a chap called Andrew Mocklin.
You ready for this?
Go on.
Budget was $15 million, which is a lower end kind of, from an independent point of view, it's higher end. From a feature, it's lower end, or £6.7 million. Holy mackerel!
That's 1989 or something. Is 1990 or something?
1989.
Yeah.
Oh man, the producers were upset with that. Holy cow! Wow.
Yeah, it's not a. But I'm really looking for. I don't think there's anything else we can say about that film. It's just unremittingly bad. But your next film, Philip, your next film is exactly what I wanted to do in this show. It's an awful film that's brilliant. So what's your second film?
Hannibal Brooks from 1969.
I mean, yeah. I mean, it's just a classic.
It's a drunk with an animal. And, you know, the hangover the elephant had was quite spectacular.
Yeah.
Or it's an animal with a drunk.
But, and the only left-handed user of a Sten gun ever.
Yeah.
Who's making it look ridiculously awkward there.
That's offensive. That's just... Is he using his forearm as a brace? Because that I'd buy.
Well, I think actually having a shit and using the Sten gun at the same time, given the facial expression, I think. Instead of putting it down like a sensible person, he's actually crimping one off while crimping one off.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, you're supposed to hold it by the barrel, right? You have to know where to hold it from the barrel.
Yeah, yeah. You're not meant to hold it from the magazine because it affects the feed of the rounds.
As I found out when it emptied a clip on me when I was holding it by the magazine.
Yeah, you can do that. But so what do you love about Hannibal Brooks, Philip? I mean...
Okay, well, there's a bit of a story to this. I went to see this film when it first came out with my grandmother. And at the time, we used to live in Manchester, and Blackpool was our usual traditional way. So we went to Blackpool. The film was on. We watched it. I enjoyed it as a young person. And I just think, to me, it's just happy memories. The storyline, most of it's pretty naff. There's a steam train in it, and some people might notice that I like steam trains. But apart from that, the story of the elephant, it goes from various towns, causing all sorts of mayhem. Along the way, they pick up an SS man but it's a lighthearted thing. You can't really take it seriously. But I like it. It's just a film that I particularly like. And if it's on, even if it's halfway through, I'll still watch it.
I mean, the ending is genuinely gripping. The ending with the, if those who haven't watched it, won't spoil it. There's a bit where they have to get to the border and there's a guard town. It's a genuinely thrilling ending. And it's directed by Michael Winner, who we mentioned earlier, is the director of Death Wish. And it's, you know, and it actually finishes with and they all lived happily ever after. The only war film I know that actually finishes with a little bouncing ball that goes across the, and they all lived happily ever after, like it's a children's thing. But
Winner got a superb performance out of that elephant.
I mean, apparently
it was three blokes in a costume. Thing. Apparently, it wasn't a real elephant. It was. No, David's got some. David, because you're the only one who has legitimately worked with elephants now. So tell us your elephant circus story that you've got about elephants ripping, just because they can't be easy to work with, but in a professional level, David, you have some genuine experience. So give us some idea what it's like to work with elephants.
They are hugely intelligent. I'm blessed actually to have been in the company of elephants. I am genuinely blessed to have been in their company for quite a long time. They're absolutely wonderfully, wonderfully clever. Like soft, gentle animals, but as well, they've obviously got a massive amount of power. My kind of story about an elephant that it just kind of summed up how clever they were. We had a German family with us about 14 or 15 years ago, and they had three elephants with them. And they used to, every day they'd put them out in this like a huge, big, electric fenced off area so that the elephants could walk around and things. And they used to have little chains, like really little light chains on their necks. And like hanging down to the ground. And I said to the guy, Hardy, that's a good German name, isn't it? I said to him, what is the situation with the little light chain? Because, somebody asks me, obviously I've got to know. So what he said was that, because they're around the neck, obviously because an elephant is like the hide is so thick and that, they wouldn't feel the touch off the electric fence. So with the chain around the neck, then if the chain touches the fence, then it gets a little tickle and it knows. So, but one day I watched this, she was a big elephant, she was. Her name was Gandhi. And I watched her digging tufts of grass with her foot and then delicately picking them up with her trunk. And she'd pick up the little bit of earth and she tried to balance it on the strand of the electric fence. And this maybe could have took her an hour because obviously, it's only you're talking about like maybe a centimeter thick, but eventually from putting on these, like digging it up, putting these little bit of sods, she was able to push the fence down. She picked up the chain in her trunk, stepped over it and buggered off.
And you've never found her since. She's still somewhere living wild in Tipperary, is that right?
Well, actually, the year that we had them, the guy, he used to bring them for walks all the time. And the amount of compensation that I had to pay that year for people's gardens, and he'd bring them to parks and they'd demolish trees and, dig up plots of stuff and, rip down a garden fence and got into an old lady's garden, and she rang the police as you would and said, there's an elephant in my back garden, which was in Lisburn and County Antrim up in the north, you know. So, but really, yeah, I'm going on. Look like beautiful, beautiful creatures.
I just put up a link of an elephant painting a picture. I remember that. Have you guys seen that?
You sent the link. Yeah, I mean, elephants are amazing. I posted a clip on YouTube. They have an elephant listening to a human playing Moonlight Sonata, and this elephant had been a captive for 61 years somewhere, and it just loves music, and you can almost see it crying. It's amazing. So, but going back to Hannibal Brooks, the interesting thing, I think, we'll show that picture of the American character played by Michael J. Pollard, who had been in Bonnie and Clyde and a couple of things. That is, I kind of think he's the pre-runner to Oddball in Kelly's Heroes, because he's playing it like a kind of a 60s beatnik, kind of lost in World War II. And I wonder whether the writers of Kelly's Heroes sort of saw that and took some inspiration for Oddball, because if you watch Hannibal Brooks now, there's definitely this kind of 60s vibe going on. I think Michael J. Pollard just turned up on set and went, I'm playing it as if it's 1968, even though it's set in 1944. But it's an interesting film. And Philip, if it comes on television, I end up watching it, because it's just, there's some genuinely exciting scenes in it. The acting is pretty good. One of Oliver Reed's better films, because he made an absolute load of crap, including a war film called Wheels of Terror, based on the books by, what's his name?
Sven Hassel,
which is, the Sven Hassel books are what they are. They're a laugh, but there's a book, Wheels of Terror, Misfit Brigade, which is dreadful. But yeah, Hannibal Brooks is a wonderful film. But I think it absolutely fulfills the category of being crap, but brilliant. It's not a, the premise is ridiculous, and the characters are kind of cliche, but a brilliant film. So they're two good submissions. So that's good. So who's next then?
Can I just make a point here, please?
Yes, you can, Colin, yes.
Well, I'd just like to say, you have just mentioned a very, very, very good war film, and I just wonder what your forfeit's going to be.
It's my show, so I can say what was the good film I mentioned? What did I say?
No. Don't sound like a Tory, Paul.
Which film did I say, Colin? Which film did I say? Which film did I say?
You know what the film was, the one that has Oddball and Clint Eastwood in it.
I've already watched Company of Heroes this afternoon for Duncan. So I'm one forfeit in advance. I'm in credit, right?
I hear you get one handicap. I've used mine. This is what I
Yeah, you get one. You get one strike. Yeah. So
changing the rules and we go along. Yes.
I am a typical Tory. That's it. I'm not a Tory at all. But it's my show. It's my rules. So yeah.
Yeah.
So Hannibal Brooks is a laugh, isn't it? It's just a great film. So, who's going next then? Matt, is it you then? Do you want to go next, Matt?
I'll go.
So your truly crap film is?
I'm going for Red Tails.
Yeah.
Yes. This is going to be controversial, but I'm going to explain why it is.
Good choice.
It's just shit. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
If my mum's watching, I do apologize, but it is awful.
Did your mum make it? Is your mum your producer?
To be fair, my mum made it. I think it would be better than the guys that did it.
I could see anything with a P-51 Mustang or a Mark 7 Spitfire. Actually, any Mark, including Mark 1. I could see any.
Chaz, they don't sound right.
The scenes are badly written, you know. Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Okay, so for those of you who have been fortunate enough not to see it, this is George Lucas of Star Wars fame's great pet project he wanted to make was a film about the Tuskegee Airmen.
A worthy cause.
Yeah, and he talked about it for years. And then after he finished the prequels, he thought, well, I've ruined everybody's childhood, so why don't I go back and ruin a bit of history? And he achieved it very well, because he tells the story of the Tuskegee Airmen, specifically the fighters, because everybody remembers the fighters pilots and not the bomber pilots. I think the thing that annoys me the most is he's gathered a cast for this thing, which is mind-blowing. You know, you've got Terrence Howard, you've got David Oyelowo, you've got Michael B. Jordan, you've got Leslie Odom. You just go through this cast list and it's incredible. You've got half the cast of The Wire. And then you've got Industrial Light and Magic putting on aerial battles for you. He's got $60 million to play with. And it, it just fails on every level because it's like they put a bunch of words into a cliche generator, crank the handle, and just throw stuff up at the wall. And you know, the HBO made a sort of reasonably budget. I think it was $6 million. The Tuskegee Airmen with Lawrence Fishburne back in the 90s.
That's very good. Yeah, that's very
and
good.
And it's brilliant. And it does what it needs to do. It tells the story of Tuskegee. It tells them of moving to North Africa and them sitting around for all that time before they even got P-40s. So you understand the battle that they went through. Whereas Red Tails basically sort of starts with, you know, a bunch of P-51s, you know, P-51Ds disappearing. Actually, no, they are Bs. They disappear off and a bunch of bombers get shot down by a comedy Nazi in an ME-109 that for some reason, and I know this is very niche complaint, for some reason, he's got all his kills down the side of his cockpit and not on the rudder where they're supposed to be. And when an ME-109 in this film gets hit, apparently the gun pods underneath the wings of the MG-151 smoke. And there's just, you've got all the tools here. And how can you screw something up this badly? And, you know, you look at, you know, you look at, oh, I made 3 pages of notes when I rewatched it the other day. Yes. And some of it is literally like, what were those gun pods? Google that. So it's, yeah. But, you know, the thing I get is you're listening to it. And I had to put some headphones on at one point. The Mustangs don't sound like Mustangs. You know, there's the Merlins that are off in it. It's when they're in the cockpit, it's silent. All you can hear is the actor sort of breathing and chatting. Nobody wears oxygen masks. There's a bit at the end when, you know, David Oyelowo dies and he gets his Oscar moment, which, you know, he's thankfully moved on from. And he's taken his mask off at 20,000 feet and starts going, I can't breathe. Oh, shit. I'm sorry. You've got the girl from NCIS LA appearing in it, talking Italian. There's no subtitles in this thing at all. It's supposed to be their perspective. But then you've got this sort of blue-eyed Nazi that they call Pretty Boy, who just keeps popping up in the single yellow-nosed fighter every once in a while. And oh God, I hate this film. I've never seen it.
I have to say. I mean, I do remember reading something about it saying that it was one of the first films where they really did a lot of the aviation in computers, and they hadn't got the practicalities of making it look real worked out yet, which makes sense because they'd come from doing the Star Wars prequels where I want to do a story about Alan Tompkins. I know I'm stealing your thunder, but Alan Tompkins was died last week, and he was a friend of mine. He was the art director on Bridge Too Far and Empire Strikes Back, and I knew Alan pretty well. And you'll like this story, Adam, because it's from an Australian.
Two strikes.
I'm mentioning in the context of someone who passed away. Sorry, that's loud. Come on, give me a break, right? So Alan Tompkins died last week, and he was the art director on all these different films. Anyway, he got a letter from an Australian guy, or Adam, who had made a model of a snow speeder from Empire Strikes Back, like a 6-foot by 8-foot model that he'd built on from blueprints, one of the Star Wars manuals. And he took it to a wind tunnel in Perth or somewhere, right? And booked this wind tunnel and did experiments with it. And he wrote to Alan with this report, like 15 bound volumes of stuff, where he was saying to Alan Tompkins, who designed the snow speed of Empire Strikes Back, that it wouldn't work. It would, at speeds of beyond so-and-so, it would fall apart. It's a crap design. You've got it all wrong. The aerodynamics are wrong. And Alan Tompkins wrote back and said, right, point one, you're assuming the gravity on the planet is the same as the gravity on Earth, and it might be different, so fuck you. And the second thing, it's for a film, it looked cool, so fuck you. So this guy genuinely was thinking that the art director, right, but yeah, sorry, we designed something that was crap. It was for a film, it was for a Star Wars film. So I can understand with Industrial Light and Magic, they've been making things that are in a fictitious universe. It doesn't matter whether the TIE fighters can do what they really have to do because it's fiction. But when you're then coming to Red Tails, if it looks wrong, it looks wrong because you're going to have people watching you who genuinely understand what G-forces are and what happens to fighters. So that's my story about that. But it is a complete pile of poo, isn't it, Red Tails? I mean,
Yeah, it's terrible. There's this thing where the German basically somehow manages to stop his plane in midair and sort of dive in behind David Oyelowo's character. And of course, you're like, oh, that's foreshadowing. He's going to do it later. And he manages to do it.
That can't happen. That can't happen. You could stall your plane. And not, it's not, actually an inverted loop, but I'm not defending it.
You definitely can. Not the way they show in this movie, though. Because apparently all you have to do is pull the stick back and cut the throttle and your plane miraculously corkscrews. It's quite something. But I think the biggest problem I have, and this is going to sound really silly, is you're already annoyed after the first 20 minutes and it cuts back to the States. And you've got Gerald McRaney as the big general, and I like him. He was in Deadwood and Jericho, all kinds of good stuff. And on his desk, he's got a P-38 Lightning, he's got a B-17, and he's got a silver bow fighter. And it's like, well, that doesn't make any sense. Why would an American Air Force general have a bow fighter in? And the problem is, I can never figure out what they're saying at that bit, because I'm looking at the desk going, why the hell is that there?
Maybe he just like
the Americans had bow fighters.
Well, but okay, I didn't know that. Oh, that's fantastic. In that case, that's why.
Well, that's a great movie, isn't it?
Adam's going to correct us now. Come on, Adam.
Yep. No. The Americans did have some bow fighters, and there's actually one in Dayton, Ohio, at the Air Force Museum.
Wow. There you go. They had a Spitfire that would take photos. There's a great story with that. It was photo reconnaissance.
So we've actually learned something. Wow.
Yeah. Thanks for bringing it.
That's my input. And I do like Red Tails. It was going to be my guilty pleasure, but I had to pick something else because you'd already taken it.
No. I'm sorry. There's nothing guilty about that. You should be guilty for liking it, mate.
I like the Star Wars prequels as well, so hate me for that too.
Oh my god! How much
stuff to get? Yeah, I don't understand you.
I do like Revenge of the Sith. Number three is okay. God, anyway,
that beer looks great.
Whole thing has been flogging a dead horse since day one. It's absolute shite.
But the thing about Red Tails, about the fighter scenes, about all the air combat, is the irony of it is Lucas actually used, for Star Wars, he used all the gun camera footage from the Second World War to basically make him do what he felt was realistic. And then it looks like Red Tails, he then decided to use Star Wars as his basis for the air combat. So it's kind of...
As a matter of fact, the TIE fighter, I'm sorry to interrupt, but the TIE fighters, are they called? Those were mosquitoes. You know, that was the dam buster.
The X-Wings. Kind of based on the movie where Guy Gibson, because I'm not going to mention Tug, I'm not getting Colin's bad books, and they're kind of mentioned on the other one about mosquitoes in Norway.
They're all used as a precedent, and then he seems to have gone back, and so he's using a lot of how TIE fighters can fly to make BF-109s fly the same way with this corkscrew stall. I mean, I think that's called a dragon's head, I think, or is it a cobra move where you stall and then drop down. But I mean, you have to gain some height in order to do that. And it's okay in a jet, but in a piston engine, I hated Red Tails. I'm with Matt with that one. I think it could have been a lot better. I'm with him. It's garbage.
There's the thing that annoys me is back in 2002, they made a terrible TV series called Taken about UFO abduction. And the opening scene of that is a raid over Germany and B-17s that get attacked by FW-190s and 109. It's only about 5-10 minutes long, but it's industrial light and magic, and it is brilliant until the UFOs come in and start nicking people out of the bombers, which gets a bit silly. And I will go back and watch that from time to time because it is brilliant. And it's the same people, and they've just completely lost all of the plot. The people who wrote it didn't have much of a plot either. But
good guy. But there's a lot of people involved in those things, so you can't blame it all on one person or any. But let's move on to your bad but good film.
There you go. I've been hiding this one in the background all day,
which is a bit of a left field, because it's our first comedy. It's our first overtly comedy show. So Operation Petticoat, Matt. So 1959, Tony Curtis, Cary Grant.
I have no notes. It's perfect.
Okay, it's perfect.
It's a lot of fun.
I mean, why do you think it justifies as being a crap movie in the first place? I mean,
okay, so the reason I put it in for a crap movie that's actually great is it's about a pink submarine in a Blake Edwards comedy with Cary Grant and Tony Curtis. And to be fair, nowadays, just saying that, you're not going to get much of a sell for it. But the thing that's, you know, when you actually sit down and watch it, you've got Cary Grant playing the straight guy to Tony Curtis, which is quite interesting. But you also have, it has this incredible way of showing this pure panic of US forces in the Philippines in December 1941. You know, they've got to get out of there. And you can be nitpicky and say, yes, they've got T-6s pretending to be German, Japanese bombers and things. But then again, just about every movie has got T-6s.
Yeah, that's a common.
But there's a few scenes in it, like when the ship gets sunk right at the beginning of the movie, the boat. And they're having these conversations about, you know, we've got to get out of here. Why are you bothering? And just this whole sort of mechanism and this, you know, there's whole gags about the paperwork that they've got to go through. And it's brilliant. And it's, you know, it's you just sort of dig into it. And yes, you've got a bunch of nurses showing up. And yes, there's gags about, you know, bras and there's a gusset being used as a spring. And, you know, it gets very Blake Edwards very quickly. But when you pick apart things like when they sink the truck, all of the torpedo sections on it are correct. And all the way through it, you've got two really stellar performances that are knocking on. And it's when you make these sort of military comedy sort of things, you know, they can go one of two ways. And this very much leans towards, you know, actually being very funny, but also not taking the mickey out of, you know, these guys who would then go on to, you know, as Ian Ballantyne says, effectively win the war in the Pacific.
Yeah.
And the boat that's actually in it is USS Balio, the lead of the class that was, you know, that class of ship was the ship that did the damage. You know, USS Tang was a Balio who had the, was it O'Kane won the Medal of Honor in her when she got sunk by her own torpedo. It is just absolutely brilliant. There are some great, great gags in it. And yeah, Tony Curtis. So yeah, Scott Grimm was just mentioned. Tony Curtis joined the Navy because he saw Cary Grant in Destination Tokyo, where he takes a submarine into the. Yeah, so you know that's why they wanted to do this. But it's. I know some people. My grandmother, who was a great Cary Grant and Tony Curtis fan, hated it because she said it was unrealistic.
What's unrealistic is that the American torpedo actually went off when it hit the truck.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. They have it or not. Yeah. I mean, the other bit of trivia about Operation Petticoat, I'm being the film nerd here, is that this is about a year after Some Like It Hot, when Tony Curtis had played the character where he used Cary Grant's voice.
Is it really?
And then he comes in to actually play against Cary Grant. And Cary Grant said, whose voice were you doing in that film, Tony? And he goes, it was you. And he goes, oh, and he hadn't.
I don't speak like that.
Because Cary Grant was born in Bristol, as we all know. So he was actually a Bristol lad from the southwest of England. Archibald Leach, who changed his name to Cary Grant, invented this whatever. So what is Cary Grant's accent, Chaz? You're there. I mean, it's not American. It's some bizarre.
It's mid-Atlantic. Errol Flynn loses his Tasmanian. And it's the acceptable mid-Atlantic.
Can you do Cary Grant?
I can't do Cary Grant, only a little bit. And it's, you know, put the
left. You're right, Chaz, you can't do Cary Grant.
He does a very good Roosevelt, Chaz. He does appear in some very important documentaries with his voices.
Thank you very much.
Chaz Mena, the man of 1,001 voices, all of them the same.
It's the same voice I do 1,001 times. No, it's an American actors, you know, who sound a lot this, had to go out and get themselves a mid-Atlantic speed if they wanted to work, you know. Why? Because the target audience is very much Britain, Australia, and the United States.
So Hollywood was making films for Anglophonic audiences. So they had to create some patois that everybody could understand, you know? And as opposed to British films, which were very well-made, excellent, brilliant films, but when they come to the United States, they seem to have been niched. That changes. Yeah. That changes. That changes by you know, it takes the war, you know, to change it by, as a matter of fact, the angry young man movement of the 1950s, you know, James Dean is copying a lot of Osborne and stuff. I mean, there's
you're being very highbrow now, but yeah.
Oh, shit. Yeah, sorry. I'll just say
Charles, fuck. Carry on. I'm with you all the way, mate.
I mean, on if you think about British war movies, up until at least the 60s, people were either Noel Coward or they were Cockney. There was nothing right. in between, was it? It was either complete
right.
upper class, top received pronunciation, or it was, all right, mate, let's go down. Yeah, there was nothing.
There was no Geordie. There was no Blackpool. I mean, you know, it was yeah, absolutely.
The classic example of that is First of the Few. So there's the opening scene when all the Spitfires are coming back. And they all come back to the hut saying there's hundreds of them up there. And that is the only time in the film you see someone who isn't an officer.
Yeah.
Really? There's one sergeant pilot. And then for the rest of the film, they're all pilot officers and above with full Etonian and actual fighter pilots as well. But
1943, wasn't it made? Yeah. So Operation Pedico, I think it only just about qualifies as a crap war film because it is a good war film, but I can see because it's a service comedy, they're not taken with the seriousness, are they? What, Colin, you're shaking your head. You're shaking your head, Colin. What? In what way are you shaking your head?
I didn't like it. I just didn't find it funny at all.
Okay.
Just missed the mark on everything. I just expected so much more from Tony Curtis. It just didn't work for me.
Well, the ladies were good looking.
Listen, I don't watch
Steals a Pig. What more do you want?
As a good looking women? I watch films.
Unless it's Penelope Cruz.
This is Penelope Cruz. Yeah, yeah. Well, we're coming up to Pearl Harbor.
About that bit.
Yeah. So, I think it's.
It's not in that to be fair.
It does mention the service comedies because, so as you said, Matt, service comedies can go from anything from the completely ridiculous kind of Carry On Sergeant kind of stuff to ones that are sort of well the one that I'm not allowed to mention with Clint Eastwood and an Oddball is a comedy, but it's not a comedy. It's a, you know, people die and it's serious and it's yeah. So that's Matt's choices. So I forget who's got to go. Have we done Adam? No, who Adam? Then let's bring. Make it worthwhile getting up at 4 a.m. So, Adam, your
about time. Okay, the terrible one is Five for Hell, and I'll show you the DVD pack after the photo. Yep, there you go.
Go on, so have you got the DVD? You actually bought it, did you?
Well, I bought 10 movies on 4 discs. Cost me about $12. So I thought, yeah, I'll have a go. And I picked Five for Hell, and I watched 20 minutes and went, that was terrible, and put it away. Then this show came up, and I thought, well, yeah, I guess I better watch the whole thing.
Oh, but, he's in it. Klaus Kinski.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's in it.
It would seem that gymnastic commandos can achieve anything. It's absolutely terrible. And like that, I made notes.
Yeah. You're probably the first person in the history of the world to do a serious study of Five for Hell. Yeah.
Well, you got to make notes just because you
got one page of notes.
Wait, you said commando.
And they're well spaced. Come on, Evan. So the first comment is about the music.
Yeah.
And it's a little bit country and western, but every now and then, because these are gymnastic commandos and their secret weapon is what I would call, if I was going to sell it on a modern website, as a tactical trampoline that you can take with you.
He's not joking, tactical folks. Trampoline. They genuinely
it's not
jump.
A joke.
Yeah.
See, the music...
We really have to go to Colin quick, guys.
Colin's about to piss himself.
I just mute me for a minute.
Anyway, so the music is a little bit country and western, but it's also a few other things. And I've written that the incidental music, just in scenes here and there, is either ragtime jazz, if that's a thing.
Yeah.
Or something that was rejected from a Hanna-Barbera cartoon. And when you're not playing those, they play these boing, boing, boing. What the hell's going on with this? And it's just absolute rubbish. I mean, I like those good movies with a where the music is, you know, big and loud and triumphant, and we know those sort of movies that
we're Elmer Bernstein's, your John Williams, yeah, of course, yeah.
And you know, those British movies from the 60s and 70s with a good, powerful music in them. But this is just absolute rubbish. And well, that's just the music.
Yeah, I mean, I think the fact it starred that, I'll put the image from the poster, it starred that well-known actor. Hang on, my thing's gone weird, hang on. It starred the well-known actor, where is it gone? I've lost my poster. No, it's gone weird. John Garko. So, I mean, John Garko is, you know, and there is a whole, I mean, Neil knows, and there's a whole series of Italian spaghetti war films they made in the 60s and 70s that Klaus Kinski appears in some of them. Often they have an imported star like Jack Palance or Lee Van Cleef or, you know, Aldo Ray, but, and they're generally a pile of crap. I mean, it's one plot fits all, but Five for Hell is about the worst.
It's terrible. It's a ripoff of, you know, get a group of rebels together and go do something behind enemy lines. It's that sort of movie. But I wrote that there were probably more gymnastics in this than the typical American cheerleader movie. And I don't watch them either. But this is just absolute rubbish. This tactical trampoline that they take around with them, I just couldn't get past it.
Yeah, no, the trailer is below. If anyone wants to watch this, the trailer is there. And the trailer has the trampoline sounds that Adam...
Oh, the boy, yeah.
It is.
And there's also, in their barracks before the actual mission itself, there's a very long tap dancing scene.
Yeah.
Why is this guy in full uniform tap dancing around his little barracks?
Or combat fatigue.
I think
I've got to watch it.
The makers were using some serious amounts of drugs, I think. It is really...
Yeah, it's very weird. There are no subtitles for any of the German spoken in it, unless they're Italian subtitles, which are no good for English speakers. Yeah, I don't know what the hell was going on there. Again.
Yeah.
I'd look at that.
Come on, Klaus Kinski does look good for a SS officer there, doesn't he?
Firing his MP40 left-handed as well, or it's flipped. That image. No, it's the right way around.
Yeah, it's right way around. Yeah.
Yeah, it's just dreadful. I mean, all those Italian ones are just dreadful. They've all got hell or commandos or desert. But some of them are soft porn as well. Some of them have just naughty scenes in the middle. I mean, really quite.
Hell, yeah. You know. Yeah. And the leader of this commando mission throws baseballs at people and knocks them out.
Oh, yes.
Because, you know, that's what Americans do, isn't it, Chaz?
But you missed a company with a sound effect. If I watched I watched a bit of the film today, and the last scene, actually, he's about to be shot by... not Klaus. Klaus Kinski's, I think, he's run out of money. He's gone home. He's done his 5 days on set. It's some other lesser-known German. And he's got the hero, John Garko, whoever the fuck he is, cornered. And then... his mate lobs him
the other guy.
He throws at the German's face, and he hits him in the face, and that's it. The war that he's won. I mean, it's just you couldn't write that scene. So we've got the hero in a predicament here. Let's have him throw a baseball at the German's face, and it's just bizarre.
That's
but it's also a relay throw. It's not a straight throw. It's a relay.
Yeah, it's not a direct throw. Yeah, it's just
I give up. It was terrible.
Thanks. What have we got? We got some baseballs. Okay, right. Rewrite the scene. He's going to chuck the baseball at that guy and we can get out of this.
Yeah, I think that's probably the theater budget. Yeah, we've got no blanks left. Yeah, just what have we got? Oh, well.
There's even a scene where they show you what they've done with the baseball. They cut it in half, separate it, put a metal ball inside, and then reassemble the baseball so it'll do more damage.
Yeah, you've overthought this now, Adam, haven't you? You've
I'd be in for that.
I have a question. How did these movies, like within, you know, collective memory of Italy, were so campy? They were kitschy. And was this a way to deal with that memory? I mean,
I don't think they made them for themselves, though. They made them to sell to other countries, I think, didn't they?
It wasn't for internal.
The Italians did make some very serious movies. There's two women with Sophia Loren and things like that. They did tackle Paisa, 4 Days in Naples. There were some very serious Italian movies that tackled some very serious subjects about Italy in World War II, but not these spaghetti.
Not this one.
No,
yeah, but Hell doesn't try and, you know.
Yeah, the Cine Verite, you know, after World War II, but after the war. But fuck, man, these movies are like, I can't stomach them, you know. I just flip over for the sex scenes, you know, seriously, because, you know, but the spaghetti.
Who are you watching, Chaz?
What, like in what, Chaz? Like in what? What movie were you going to tell us about?
Oh, what? Oh, no.
With the sex scene, Colin and Duncan.
Offline!
Enemy of the Gates has a good one, doesn't it? Enemy of the Gates has Rachel. Anyway, we're going off plot now. Your good film, but actually your crap film, but good, Adam. Then we'll go to Colin. So your good film.
Okay. It might not be so well known outside Australia, but there it is, The Odd Angry Shot.
It's
a Vietnam War movie. It's a whole Australian cast, apart from some American guys who are apparently from the stereotypical sort of black Louisiana. They walk around jiving through Saigon or whatever place they've gone to. So that's a little bit of Americans in it. But it's a very famous Australian movie, very popular Australian movie. The actors are Australian, so they sound Australian, because really the Brits and the Americans can't do Aussie accents. Sorry. It's just not right.
I'm sure we are not Cockneys.
We're not Cockneys. I just have to tell you all that, because that's the accent that we end up with when someone else tries it.
Are you talking Dick Van Dyke and Mary Poppins? Yeah. He's doing Cockney, but ends up sounding Australian. Then there's James Coburn in the film. I'm not mentioning it so I don't upset Colin, but the one with the tunnel and Stalagmite 3, where James Coburn's playing an Australian as if he's from, I don't know, Watford or something.
Oh my God, that's awful.
But yeah. No, I mean, I love The Odd Angry Shot. It's very funny. There's some really good, and it's about, I'm not sure to let Adam talk, but it's about the Australian SAS in Vietnam, who were there.
Yes, they were there.
They but only the had one is, person killed in the entire conflict, didn't they, I believe?
They were the best fighting soldiers in that campaign.
In combat.
From best. Enemy action.
Yeah, from enemy action, yeah.
Yeah.
But so about 20 die in the film.
Yeah, so there are more SAS die in this movie than actually died in Vietnam, to the best of my knowledge, and I'll throw that in. But yeah, we had terrible beret wearing in that Danny Dyer movie that we mentioned at the start.
Age of Heroes, yep.
This also features lots of terrible beret wearing. Also, according to this movie, and I'm not sure how true it is, I don't think it is, on the fire support base in Vietnam where these soldiers were, they wore their beret around the camp. Now, why you would do that, I have no idea. These are the SAS, they're professional guys. They know exactly what's going on. Why they're wearing their berets around the camp, I don't know. But apparently, the book that this was based on was written by an SAS guy who was in Vietnam. He started off as a cook and worked his way up. So I guess that's one way to do it. But the scenes... If you think of a person telling a story, say he's got a 3-hour story, but he's in another room, and every now and then you walk into the room, stay for 2 minutes and then walk out. Each of those 2-minute things that you hear, even if you walk in halfway through a story, put all those together and make that movie.
Yeah.
So yeah. It's a bunch of different incidents, half of which you don't know how and why it happened because you come in halfway through.
Yeah. It's like skits. It's like Monty Python sketches. Though yeah. There's some very funny bits. Then it goes back into combat, back then to funny, but it doesn't, it's not very coherent, is it? I love it. It's a great movie, but it's a crap movie. It fulfills.
You don't know if you should be happy or sad or angry or excited because in 2 minutes it's going to change.
The tone is all wrong, isn't it? It changes. Yeah.
You can have a film that has, it's episodic, right? It has episode, but it's got to have a rhythm. It's got to have a rhythm. It's got to, you know, go forward and
yeah. Forward. I mean,
does it have that? Does it?
No.
No, they go out on patrol. They come back. They tell a couple of one-liner jokes. They go out on patrol. Nothing happens. They come back. They tell a couple of one-liner jokes. It's just that over and over. It's like the guy who wrote the book was telling the film director, oh, and then this happened. Okay, we'll make that a story. Oh, and one day this happened. Okay, we'll make that the story. In one part, the first thing you see is a guy lying down wounded, covered in bandages, and then calling in a helicopter. You go, what? They were just in camp a minute ago. Now they're all in their camouflage gear and someone's been hurt and they're getting a helicopter. Apparently he trod on a landmine, but you don't see that because that would cost money.
He couldn't walk, then could he?
Have you seen it, Duncan? Have you seen Not Angry Shot? Because I remember when I grew up in Colchester, all the squaddies thought it was a classic.
I haven't seen it.
I remember having discussions in pubs, and they all said it, the advance, the contact, the patrolling. Because there was patrols they went on where they didn't engage the enemy. It was just advance, and they fell back, which to me is very realistic. Not every patrol ends up with some big, you know, bust up, especially reconnaissance stuff, because they're recon, they're SAS. So some of it, I remember guys I knew in the army said it was very realistic, and it was a very popular late night one to watch in the barracks. But you've not seen it, Duncan, so.
So the SAS had two jobs in Vietnam, basically, and their job depended on the task force commander. So a new task force commander would come in, and then the SAS commander would meet with him and say, what do you want us to do? Do you want us to hunt them down, or do you want us to actually go kill some? And their task for the rest of that commander's time would be whatever he allocated. So sneaking around, seeking out the enemy is perfectly legitimate activity.
Yeah.
And not firing your weapon is perfectly fine if that's what the commander wants you to do. He just wants you to find them and then he'll take care of them with the regular infantry or artillery or whatever. But the story is just so chopped up that you don't know where you're going, you don't know how to feel, and sometimes you don't even know really what's going on.
Like that landmine scene.
You hear jets sometimes, but you never see them. So that they had enough money for the sound effect, just not enough money for the aircraft. Plane. Yeah, but there are Australian Iroquois gunships in it. I think we had about four. So that they use some of them for the scenes. So the patrolling scenes are good. They're moving slow. They're sneaking around. Their camouflage is good the first time because they camouflage the whole face because you don't want to leave any shiny bits. The second time, they do the whole a camouflage kit that I used to have when I was in Army Cadets had three colours, so black, green and brown. You put three fingers in and then you wipe it down your face. That's what they did the second time. So there's still bits of white. The third time, they just gave them a bit of boot polish and they went, oh, nose, chin, cheeks. Yeah, that's camouflage. So it got worse as the movie went along and they've, I guess, relied on the actors to, you know, remember what we did the first time? Just do that. And it just got worse and worse and worse and worse.
Perhaps they ran out of cam cream. Perhaps they only had one stick to use or something and they ran budgetary constraints again, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's worth watching. I watch it every now and then. I always kind of enjoy it, but it's one of those ones I watch and I go, yeah, it could have been so much better. Hence why it's a crappy film. But yeah, like Neil's Attack and Retreat, it's got more merit than it is. It's worthy, but didn't quite make it, is how I see it. You know, it's
absolutely. And I'll have a go at the music as well, because if you think of 1970s, and this is made in 79, so 1970s police dramas, maybe that sort of thing, when something mysterious is about to happen, you'll get some drums and a trumpet, so boom, 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 da-da-da! They have that in this war movie. You know, when they're sneaking through the jungle or about to creep up on a hut or something like that. But it is very Australian. The language is Australian. The expressions are Australian. The accents are Australian. The equipment is Australian. So it's very true in that aspect. I feel as an Australian watching it, I feel that, you know, we are reflected in it. But as a war movie, it doesn't quite know what's going on. But yeah, if you haven't seen it, I'd say
it probably could do with a remake, couldn't it? It's probably why those movies is worth picking up and remaking today, because Australia's made some cracking war films, you know. So
well, Australia. There was a Vietnam War movie released a year or two ago. I won't say its name because I think it's a good one.
Yeah. I know the one you mean. Yeah, I haven't seen
about it. About a very specific battle in Vietnam that also involved the New Zealanders. And regardless of...
Jim Foxborough?
Well, I don't think so. The guy from Vikings was the lead.
No.
It was quite good. I'm not an expert on Vietnam or that particular battle, so I can't comment on the very specific details of it. But overall, I thought it was quite good.
So, yeah, you've made some good films.
So I'd recommend that.
I think you should be allowed to mention the movie because I don't know what you're talking about. So please mention it without forfeit.
If you don't know it, it's okay to mention it. Okay.
Okay. The movie is called Danger Close.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's excellent.
So basically, the guys in the battle called in artillery basically on their own position because they thought they were going to be overrun. And that's the origin of the title.
We'll do a movie night, Colin. We'll watch it here or something.
I shall look that up.
So I think we need to move on a bit because we're coming up in 2 hours soon. So, Colin, it's your turn to bring your two movies in now, then me. So, Colin, you're two.
I kind of misunderstood the brief here because I picked two absolute bloody turkeys.
Yeah, but it's... Yeah, okay.
I don't like either of them. And so I'm going to start with the one that will annoy you the most, Paul.
No, save that one for second. Now go with the other one first.
Because then people will think that I think this has got a redeem. Well, it has one redeeming quality. Okay,
it's got seven.
It's got one.
It's got seven.
That's footballers in it. So I'll start with Escape to Athena.
No, okay. Escape to Athena.
I'll start with that one because,
no redeeming features.
It has. It's coming up right now.
It's Stephanie Powers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Mr. Bronson there from Grange Hill.
Yes. That's it. I watched it this afternoon. I was trying to think what the.
Which is where he got his anger from, you know.
Do you know what the thing is about your man there who plays him, Sergeant, whatever he is in the bloody movie? He must be the only man in the history of acting who has played every single rank of the German army right up to Führer.
Yeah, he's been Hitler, isn't he? He was Hitler. Yeah.
He's been
and he was in Star Wars.
Yeah, Admiral.
You can't make a movie without Germans and without him in it. But the thing is, the movie doesn't know what it wants to be.
Exactly, yeah.
Is it a serious... Because you watch the first 10 minutes and think, hang on a minute, this is a serious war movie. When the Germans are chasing down the prisoners and recapturing the prisoners, and then they execute a guy at random because Sonny Bono with his 1975 haircut, despite the fact the movie was 1989 or something, he's a kook. And the Auntie Valentine, whose accent's in and out all the time, is the SS major. He just says, you never kill a kook, so kill that man, hang that man instead, and they hang him from there. And you think, this is a serious movie. And then it just goes downhill from there. It really does. It is just awful. It's just a series of cliches. And it doesn't know if it wants to be a comedy. It doesn't know if it wants to be a kind of a bank heist caper at the end or serious war movie. It, that's its problem. It just does not know what kind of movie it wants to be. You've got the motorbike chase, which is a homage to The Great Escape, of course. Elliot Gould with his sidecar chase. He's got another 1980s haircut. Chasing Auntie Valentine, doing his Steve McQueen impressions, jumping over mules on carts and things like that. And it then three frogmen appear from bloody nowhere. And you just think, what's going on? It just doesn't know what it wants to be. It really doesn't. It's a bloody awful movie. It really is.
I mean, it's trying to borrow from all the genres. It's trying to be Bond and spy films and space, because the rocket program thing is kind of, because it's the same year as Moonraker. Is it trying to tap in on that kind of space? It's, I mean, Matt, you're the film buff. What do you think on Escape to Athena? It's,
it is one of those things that comes up usually either, you know, Saturday evening when you're just home from the pub and you've for some reason put men to movies or whatever it's called on, and
movies for men.
That's the one. There you go. Colin's a subscriber.
And it's called war films, by the way. It's not porn.
Yeah. For those who don't know, it is war films and westerns. Yeah.
If you come home a little bit worse for wear, and the clip picture you just showed of the Germans with the reflecting motorcycle helmets come on, and that pops up. If you weren't lost beforehand, and they all start marching out, flipping heck! It gets. I like a good weird. You know, this is E-list movie here, but there's nothing redeeming in this. Even thingy's legs, and I say that being a huge David Niven fan.
Everyone's past their best. Elliot Gould was hot property 5 or 6 years earlier, but he's on the way down. Richard Roundtree, Shaft, is on the way down. Sonny Bono, I don't think ever had an up except when he did I Got You, Babe, back in 64. He's on the down. David Niven was ill, I think. Roger Moore, he's still the star. Roger Moore is still Bond, isn't he?
But top villain.
He plays it with an Austrian accent that's somewhere, that little part of Austria just near in Kent, that little, the Austrian highlands of Sussex, you know. It's just,
The Republic of Kent.
The Republic of, it is a truly dreadful film, except I do want, and I'm not going to, I probably sound terribly sexist, but when Stephanie Powers takes a kit off, it is quite watchable then. Philip, is that one of the ones you remember from your, you know, Escape to Athena? It's definitely a Saturday afternoon flick, isn't it?
I never actually saw it.
Well.
Until I got the Daily Mail set.
The Daily Mail got
rid of a lot. That's the one I watched this afternoon, just to remember it has been as bad as I thought, and it is bad.
I watched it 2 days ago. It was awful.
Yeah.
Because his son produced the movie.
Yeah.
He was one of the major money men on the movie, which is why David Niven agreed to do it. And he was ill at the time to do it. And I am a big David Niven fan, I have to say.
He did make a lot of movies just for the cash, though, towards the end, didn't he?
I do.
And there's nothing wrong with that. I've done stuff for cash as well. So
we'll get too big a rating if you tell us those stories, Paul.
Yeah, no, they're not very exciting. It's just, you know. I'm not doing that. Let's not go there. But I mean, Duncan, we haven't brought you in much, Duncan. You're sitting there very patiently. You're the only proper soldier here amongst us, really. When you see it, do you judge tactics? Do you look at how the weapons handling goes in these things, or do you try and switch off and enjoy them?
I try to switch off, but unfortunately you can't. The eye just goes in. You notice the way they're handling, reloading the weapons, etc., the equipment, everything. It's just absolutely terrible. So you have to switch off from it. You really, really do. I mean, that's why I love Age of Heroes, because I think it's just an action film. You know, it's a good, enjoyable film. That Captain Mandel, whatever his name is, that one there, I watched that when it first came out. And I mean, that was a chick flick. I mean, just absolutely terrible. And I see, you know, the side with the Italians and everything else, you know, with it. And I see the other side of the the argument. But to me, that just made me want to turn it off. You know, absolutely terrible. I haven't seen the aircraft one that Amanda was talking about.
Red Tails.
I haven't seen that one. No, I haven't. And I haven't seen the Australian SAS one.
Now, I'll lend you that. It's worth watching. I think you'll enjoy that.
Yeah,
it's worth it.
our training, our sort of training in the early 80s in the military, our training films were you get back from the pub on a Friday and a Saturday night with a curry, and you sit there, you know, with your tin thing and your spork, you know, shoveling it down. And there was an American Vietnam program. It was a series, and there was a guy that called, who was a sergeant called Zach.
Call of Duty.
That's the one, yeah.
Call of Duty, I mean, yeah, that was dreadful. That was awful.
We had that.
I don't think it ever finished. I think it's still running round, isn't it? I don't think they ever actually finished it. It's still running late night. It's just always
not as,
there.
Not as bad as China Beach. That was just,
China Beach was great.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the training movie. You know, we used to watch that, and we all used to sit there, and I mean, the drills with the ARs and everything else, and the M6, it was good stuff, you know, and the thumpers, the M79s, you know, it was really, really good stuff for us, you know, especially when you've had a skinful.
Yeah.
What outfit were you wearing, if you don't mind my asking?
Oh, I was guards, as you can tell.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Oh, here we go.
I was going to be a Marine. Oh,
well, let's have your second one, Colin, because I'm going to get ready to get very defensive, and I'm hoping Neil is going to get in my corner here as well, because you know, come on, what is it?
It is absolutely a pale of shade.
Oh no!
Oh man! Oh yeah! Oh yeah!
Or Victory, as it was called in the United States.
Yeah.
And the release date in the United States was actually June 6th, 1981.
Really?
Hilly!
Yeah. And June 6th.
Johnny Walk.
Exactly. And there is John Walk.
Shut up! My pick, shut up!
Yeah.
The tagline for the movie is "Their goal was freedom." Oh yeah, God, where to start with this film? It is just dreadful. Yeah. And it's, do you know what? I said I picked two dreadful movies because I misunderstood the brief. The one redeeming quality of this movie, and it only applies to people of our generation, Paul, is we can spot the footballers.
Yeah.
And that is the only reason for watching this film. And do you know when this was first aired on the TV? We didn't have satellite TV. We didn't have wall-to-wall football every week, right? So the first time it was on TV, it was around about 83, 84. Anything with football in, you would watch. And yeah. Bobby Moore was only recently retired. John Walt might as well retired for what he did when he went to Liverpool.
Ooh!
That's for you, David! Aussie R Dealers, who'd made the song with the Tottenham Hotspur squad, said he's on his way to Wembley with Tottenham. Thank God for that, because as an actor, he wasn't going to get an Oscar. It is just so bad. It's everything, and I'm going to mention a film and fuck your forfeits. It's everything The Great Escape isn't.
Yep.
Because The Great Escape's a fantastic movie. And when you watch that, no matter how many times you've seen it, you are still willing Steve McQueen over that fence.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, but even
when
that,
you watch Escape the Victory, because you stumble across it on the TV, you think, "Well, fucking, how long's left?"
No, see, I'm going to get very defensive in a minute.
So, Paul, I'm going to tell the world why you think this is defendable. And it's because it's got Ipswich Bloody Town players in from the last time you won a trophy.
Absolutely, yeah, that's it.
Team won a trophy.
Pardon?
When did it come out?
It came out in 81, and that was the last.
Yeah, that's UEFA, isn't it? That's UEFA Cup.
Yeah, go.
I saw it.
So I'm going to duck out and let you to extol the virtues of an absolute feckin' turkey of a movie. Off you go, gentlemen.
Is this the one where they break someone's arm so Sylvester Stallone can?
They don't just break someone; they break Kevin O'Callaghan, the Ipswich striker's arm, because seven members of the Ipswich Town UEFA Cup 1981 winning squad were in that movie. How do I know that? Because I'm a bloody Ipswich Town fan, and the seven were John Walk and Russell Osman as named players in the Allies squad. Robin Turner and Laurie Civil were on the German team. Kevin O'Callaghan is the goalkeeper, who's actually a striker in real life, who had to break his arm so Sylvester Stallone could take over the role as goalkeeper. But little known, is Paul Cooper, the Ipswich goalkeeper, doubled for Sylvester Stallone during the football match, and Kevin Beattie, the greatest player to ever play for Ipswich ever in the history of the world, was the double for Michael Caine. And if you look closely, because I have, you can actually tell the bits where Kevin Beattie is playing Michael Caine, because he can actually
tackle and
pass. Because Michael Caine looked...
A lot of people know that.
What?
Can I butt in?
Yes. Michael's
character is called John Colby.
Yeah.
The person who lived next door to me and I went to school with when I was a kid was called John Colby. He was about as good at football as Michael fucking Caine was.
Well, Michael Caine was 48 when he made it, and about 5 stone overweight. And he's...
So was Bobby Moore, to be fair.
But it's Bobby Moore. You give Bobby Moore a leave because it's Bobby Moore. But yes, the Ipswich connection is what makes it special for me. But also, you'd have to have a heart of stone to not be moved by the scene towards the end when the whole stadium starts going, Victoire, and the Marseille. That's a good bit, isn't it? Isn't that a good bit?
Yeah.
To be fair, Paul, it's nearly as good as the cagoules as they're running out of the stadium.
Yeah, there, you can see. When all the fans run on, they're all wearing, they've all been to Prague's and Primark, haven't they? They're all running out in flares and jackets and stuff. But did you know, I did some research. It is based on a true story and B, an earlier movie. A 1964 Hungarian movie came out called Two Halves of Hell. And it was about a Hungarian team that were forced to play against the Germans. And that is based on a real incident that Philip might know about because he's the German Nazi blah, blah student of a real... There were football matches played in the Ukraine between Ukrainian teams and the Germans. A lot of scandal about it. And so Escape to Victory has some kind of premise in the war with regards to football matches between Germans and Allies. Yeah, have you got anything to add on that, Philip?
That was my
between question. Dynamo Kiev and the German side. I think there was a book written about it, wasn't there?
Yeah.
There are cases of football games going on.
Yeah.
And the German national side was playing Italy, Hungary. So I know there was a fair amount of football going on at the time, but it's not something I've studied. So sorry.
There was in prisoner of war camps, and many of the prisoner of war camps, the British prisoners would split by the United Kingdom's nationalities and play the home internationals for everybody who old enough to remember home internationals, and would play them in the prisoner of war camps. And the German guards would often ask if they could put a team into the competition, and they were generally refused.
Yeah.
Say that again. I missed that. Say that again. Sorry. Sorry. I beg your pardon. What was that?
In the prisoner of war camps, the British nationals would split down into their 4 nation groups. And we had a competition finished many years ago called the Home Internationals, which was the end of every football season. The four nations, England, Scotland, Ireland and Wales, would play a competition to decide who was the British champions. And so that's what they did in the prisoner of war camps. Just to pass time, they would have these international games by group. And the German guards would often ask if they could enter a team, and it was generally refused.
Oh, good.
You know what I also like about the Escape to Victory, and you'll have to back me up on this one, it's about enlisted men in a prisoner of war camp, because we've talked about this before at the pub, Colin and Duncan. Mm-hmm. Most of the POW films are about the toffs in Colditz and all that stuff, and it's all about getting one over on Matron, isn't it? And if you remember the Escape to Victory, the guys don't necessarily want to escape. They've done their bit. They've been captured. They're in a camp. They've not got enough to eat. They don't want to go and do escaping heroics. They leave that to the officers because of that, you know, that whole, as I say, getting one over Matron. So I like the fact they portray enlisted men that have been captured. And if you've been captured at Dunkirk in 1940 and 4 years later someone asks you to escape, you're in no condition to physically get out of that camp anyway because you probably lost about 4 stone in weight.
Yeah.
You haven't been fed properly. So I like the fact, and it also has the Russian prisoners they bring in because remember when Colby asks, if this is a world team, we should better bring some Russians and Poles in. And Max von Sydow, the German, brings the Poles and they've come out of like Dachau or somewhere. So it's
But there is Kazmierz
Dana. The Polish striker is one of them, isn't he?
Watching this for my pronunciation, but what a wonderful footballer he was.
And the football scene is allowed
to come to the West and play in the big leagues. He would have been one of the world's greatest footballers. He was a fantastic player.
But the top footballer in the film is Pele.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's why I saw it. My dad and I went to go see it because of Pele. You know?
And the worst
he choreographed all the action and it was, yeah.
And the worst footballer in the film is Mike Summerby.
Oh, now, come on.
Depends come which part of Manchester you come from. I noticed from.
Behind your head there was a book, and I'm pretty certain it's George Best on the cover. Am I correct?
It's a Park Drive book.
On your bookshelf, there's a book with, I think it's George Best.
The Park Drive Book of Soccer. Yeah.
Is it George Best?
Yeah. It's Georgie Best, yeah.
Which team in which East Anglian team did George Best play a game for, Neil? Who was that? Yeah.
Was it Ipswich?
He played in Alan Hunter's Testament. There are photos of George Best wearing an Ipswich shirt. He knew. As soon as he put that shirt on, he realised he'd wasted his career.
I went to school with Alan Hunter's son, and Alan Hunter was a nice guy because in the off season he would teach carpentry to learning disabilities.
Yeah,
that's what he used to. He was a generally nice guy. He was from Northern Ireland, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was. Great, nice guy.
I know we're not supposed to be mentioning good movies in this.
You can. But
there's a really good football movie that nobody's seen. It's called The Keeper.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
I saw it recently. Yeah, it's really good.
Absolutely superb movie.
But for those watching, that's a forfeit.
Bert Trautman, isn't it?
I'll take the forfeit for that because it is a good movie.
Hey, fellas. Do you know if I'll ask my Canuck neighbor here. Did they ever play baseball in any of the camps or
rounders?
Comment of the night, Mr. Lawrence. I doff my hat to you there. my American viewers are now just all dropping now. That's it. Now they'll go, yeah.
They must have, because Steve McQueen's got a mitt, hasn't he? So
yeah, he has.
Yeah, but you've got
to be putting a mitt. That's so wrong to have an American there. Not one American was, but the Americans left the camp before the, in fact.
Yeah, they've been moved to Camp C or something, haven't they? We'll do that film in another show. So, Escape to Victory, I think it's got merit. And, you know
it's nostalgia for us, Paul. It's nostalgia. Exactly. It's when we were good.
It's looking back to the halcyon days of when Ipswich were a good team, which will come again.
The Blues.
The only merit Escape to Victory has is proof that you can direct a film blind drunk, as John Huston clearly did.
It is what it is. You take it and you leave it. So we're moving on. Let's go to Chaz now, and Chaz's two films. So Chaz, your absolute stinking turd is?
Ladies and gentlemen, a little piece of putrid shite, as you would call it, Pearl Harbor. I sat there like this. You know? I mean,
for 2.5 hours, yeah.
Yeah, it was offensively bad, you know? And I mean, I had a chance, a director, Michael Bay, not to name drop. I got a chance to work with Michael Bay, and I asked about it.
Name dropper.
Yeah, totally, right? No, but I mean, it's appropriate because I said, hey, I saw Pearl Harbor. And he looks at me and he goes, piece of shit, Ron. And he was trying me, you know, like he was, and I was like, well, no, I mean, that's all I said. Because, I mean, I'm going to ask my British cousins. Wasn't it offensive to see Ben Affleck's character, Ralph McCrawley, in the Battle of Britain? And then seeing the crew member going, gosh, or some shit like that. And do you know what I mean? It was like it was
the line where the squadron leader said, "If only we had more of you, we'd win this war."
Oh god, yeah.
I mean, that, I mean, I'm an American, and that profoundly pissed me off.
Hands up if you are if you are from the Britain and the Commonwealth and you're offended by Pearl Harbor. or Ireland, sorry.
Well, I'm a wannabe Brit.
Okay. Colin wasn't offended by it. Okay.
I was totally offended by it. I mean, it's the
problem. I think Colin watched it for the women.
And it put back
20... Colin did watch it. He wasn't offended by it, but it was a pile of shite.
Yeah, okay.
But even the love relationship was fatuous at best. Look at that. Okay, she's hot. But I mean,
she's very hot.
Not Penelope Cruz, though.
That's true. That's very true. I was her boyfriend. No.
Colin, you would with a Celtic shirt on it.
Right, yeah. No, I got to tell you the truth. Even the love, I mean, Tora 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 didn't have a love thing going on, you know?
Because war movies don't need it.
Yeah.
It's not needed. There was no time to indulge in that.
No.
You know, I mean, it's taking, okay, now American perspective. It's taking a milestone in the history, right, of the United States, because it's really when one becomes, on the world scene. Even after World War One, we all know there's a retraction, perhaps a healthy retraction. And then all of a sudden there's Pax. Look, it's propagating the idea of that American one alone. And it's the shining city on a hill. It's the fact that we did it. It's nationalistic. It put back history classes for 25 years all over the country. It's offensive to our allies. And then on top of everything, it's laced with CGI. I don't think the attack was properly. It looked like a video game.
Yeah, it did. Yeah.
You know, it looked like a video game. It was okay. I understand. What was interesting is using the two pilots that actually did get airborne and did some harm on some Zeeks with a P-40 Tomahawk. You know, which was not a bad plane.
No.
You get altitude on that thing and you go down on a dive and you can go over 400 miles an hour. And that was a big deal for a plane that was designed for what? 1936, Paul? 36,
I think,
36?
Yeah, about that, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, and that was a frontline American fighter at the time. And so you could do a little bit of harm with that. It was an Army Air Corps. The Navy didn't have it. The Navy had shit. They had Bobcats, which was like a flying crate. But, okay, that's interesting. Use those two characters as the protagonists, but they weren't used. They were not used effectively. And it was also the caricature of the American character, you know, of the happy-go-lucky, the bumbling guy who hits historical heights and glory by accident because he's just a fun-loving, generous type, you know. But what did it for me was that scene in the Battle of Britain, because I have an obsession with the Battle of Britain. I was, I studied, it's not about me, but I got a visual flight rating on a Cessna 150. And, you know, I was a 17-year-old kid and I was all about the Battle of Britain. And I'd come in and I'd go, coming in 180. And then the guys on the ground would say, I'll knock it off, Chaz, will you? I was punk, I was a kid. And that's the reason why I got into flying. Because of reading about that milestone. I don't know, you know, I was offended by the story. And then the story wasn't effective.
And doesn't Ben Affleck also do the 30 seconds over Tokyo as well? Doesn't he do that as well in the movie?
Yeah.
he turns Pearl Harbor into a victory. He wins the Battle of Britain for us. Very grateful. Thank you very much, Governor, for saving our nation. And then he goes and drops bombs on Tokyo as well and escapes and gets back, doesn't he? Or did he die? I can't remember.
No, he gets back.
He gets back, doesn't he? I mean, it's just
he's gotta get he's gotta get back because he's knocked up his mate's missus.
Yes. You mean there was a complicated love triangle that couldn't be resolved? That's what they're the words you're looking for, Matt. Not he knocked up his best mate's missus.
I want to get Chaz's take on this because Cuba Gooding Jr. is in it as Dory Miller, who won Medal of Honor at Pearl Harbor for 4 minutes. It's a 3-hour film, and the one interesting story in it, they spend like, this is Cuba serving coffee, this is Cuba shooting a gun, this is Cuba getting the Medal of Honor.
And you're like, he's the perfect he's the perfect Negro, my boy. You know, I mean, that's what he plays, you know, and it's he's not given enough screen time. Now, mind you, in all of this, I've wanted to say, with all due respect, a lot of times it's not all these shit films. It's not really the director; it's the editor. The editor really makes a film, but the director is sitting next to the editor, and behind the director is the producer. So you would think that among those three people or teams of people, they would somehow come to some viable story. But you know, all that money, and you know, also there's a professional jealousy for me, because motherfucker, if I had $25-30 million, you know, I would make, you know what I would make? I would make the El Alamein movie.
Ooh, yes. Do it.
Yeah. I've got a quid here somewhere. I can have you. We'll get you rolling, Charles.
It would start with the fall of Tobruk, right? And the climax would be October 22nd, you know, that night going in with the tape on the side and the mine, you know. And yeah, okay, I'm going to be nationalistic. I'd have an American volunteer, played by me.
Exactly, my granddad.
yeah, you can. But you'd have to play your granddad in 1973, because you're a little bit older to play your granddad in 1942.
Don't you see it?
My granddad died in 77.
Yeah. So. No, but I mean, Pearl Harbor. We need to kind of move on a bit now. But Pearl Harbor is an absolute stinking pile of crap.
It is. The story is ineffectual. Every story has an inciting incident that makes everything happen. There was no inciting incident. It was like, I'm a badass. I'm a Doolittle. I'm flying Spitfires. They don't even give me a Hurricane because I'm American. They're going to give me a Mark I Spitfire. You know, because I'm cutting edge. I mean, come on, give me a flying car.
Chaz, can I just ask you a serious question?
What's that?
Pearl Harbor is honking. It's a terrible film. What is your take on Midway? Yeah.
The latter Midway, the recent
Midway. Yeah, the new one.
You know, I'm going to sound like it's professional jealousy, but I didn't like it. You know, did you?
No,
I didn't like it. I mean, look, I'll say one thing. I was taken by the dive bombing, the last...
At the end, yes, but there's so much unnecessary filming goes on before it.
Killer.
Yeah.
Killer. Every story, every Hollywood story, and that's the problem with Hollywood, it's old wine and new bottles. Old wine and new bottles. Old wine and new bottles. It's always the inciting action, the rising action, the indefatigable, inevitable climax, right? And then the adjustment and the denouement, and then, you know, but those steps were missing in Pearl Harbor for me, you know. And I'll be honest with you, I walked out of the fucking film. I was in grad school, and I was with my now lady, you were dating, and I said, I can't stand it. And she said, good, because I hate war movies. She doesn't talk like that, but she's Cuban, and I did the accent for her. Paul, did you like it?
I did. So, I'm slightly aroused. Yeah, no, it's brilliant. Wonderful. Yeah, no.
Anyway, I just want you to know that there are Americans that looked at it and said, this is bullshit. All right. So,
I'm conscious of the fact time is, we ought to move on to your next choice now. So your stinking turd that's actually good.
Force 10 from Navarone.
Yeah.
Genius, genius movie.
Now, who wrote it? That's what's interesting, is Alistair MacLean, of course, the Scottish novelist who dies in 1987. And you would think that's, you know, I mean, it was a good movie. It sold well. It paid for itself and made a little bit more money. And the director, how can you miss? I mean, it was Guy Hamilton who did Goldfinger, who did Forever, Live and Let Live, Golden Gun, you know, Man of the Golden Gun. And he was the dude, you know, he was interesting. He was a Royal Navy 15 motorboat flotilla. So I guess he didn't get past Kent, right? He was in the English Channel or maybe made one trip to Norway from Scapper's Flow. I mean, what did he do? What did the motorboat flotilla do, you know? But But really, he spent his time in right after the war, British Panorama, and Carol Reed took him under his wing. So he had a career because of Carol Reed, possibly one of the best directors of the 20th century. I don't care. The Third Man is not really a war film. The Third,
Third Man. Brilliant film.
Perfects. Film it's perfect noir film. Five thriller.
Perfect film.
It's a perfect film. The way it's shot, the way it's acted. Okay, so the acting here. Everybody was one step removed. Everybody was having fun. It was tongue in cheek. They weren't really serving the script. The script was not bad. I mean, the genre is action. But I felt like even Edward Fox, you know, was, I mean, it was campy. It was bordering on campy, right? It was just bordering on campy. Carl Weathers, it's nice to have an African-American, have any, you know, black performer there. I remember that I didn't re-see it. I just remembered because I used to, when I was 12, I was like, Dad, it's for Sam from Navarro. And they go, great, put it on. Remember that dialogue he has with Edward Fox? And he goes, Edward Fox says, oh, where did you go to school? And he says, I went to the University of Harlem. And he goes, I don't know that. What is that? Do you know what I mean? There was potential for comedy, and that was like one of the better scenes. The one thing I really liked is when Edward Fox says, wait, and then slowly.
Oh, the dam. Yeah.
The dam is attributably knocked out. You know, so that was nice. That was a nice bit of writing. But you had the same problem with Forever magazines on Schmeisers, on MP40s, and you know, people didn't run out of ammunition. The premise of the film was hokey. Historically, I think irresponsible. You know, the partisans were okay. The Chechniks that come out and flip their hats, that was a nice touch. But I felt like people, they were having too much fun at the expense of some really horrible things. And that's my big problem. I don't mean to be all serious about it.
Well, I mean, we could bring Neil in here as well, because the Yugoslavian campaign was really shitty and really pretty barbaric. And the rivalry between the Chetniks and the various partisans and Tito, it's very complicated. And Force 10 from Navarone turned it completely into just simplistic
camp,
hammy. Although I did think Franco Nero was brilliant in it.
Yes,
as the baddie. I think he stole it for me, because Matt, you wanted to have this as your guilty pleasure as well, didn't you, Matt?
So
I did,
but Chaz snaked it out from underneath me.
He did.
There it is.
I reckon I like that.
Yeah,
I love this film.
Lately, anyway.
The thing I love about it is you've got Harrison Ford sort of between Star Wars movies. You've got Carl Weather between the two best Rocky movies. Yeah, you've got Edward Fox counting his money, which is always good fun. Robert Shaw counting his money. But then you've got Franco Nero actually trying to make a fist of a terrible script and doing not a bad job. And, you know, it all hinges on a dodgy salute, which you got to love.
But, you know, the screenwriters were really good. Robin Chapman, you know, Carl Foreman. These are established British and American. Carl Foreman, you know, these are really good.
It should have been better than it was, but it's again.
And it's got Barbara Buck.
Like Hannibal Brooks we had earlier, when it comes on, I'll put it on and it will stay on. I mean, it's just...
Why do I like
it? What do you think, David? Some of these ones we've covered recently. I mean, Force 10 from Navarone, does it get a thumbs up from you?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. No, I like this, yeah. And to say anything with Barbara Buck in it is okay for me too.
Mrs. Ringo Starr, yeah. No, she's topping it. It's good. I mean, it's not good, but it's... It serves the purpose of what we're talking about, of being worthily good, but still crap. You know, it's entertaining, and right, Chaz. They're all playing it for comedy, and there should have been a few more people playing it seriously. You can have the odd person playing it for laughs, but you need someone keeping it straight. And there was not really anyone keeping it straight. Robert Shaw, because he only died a couple of years after, wasn't he? Because he did. Avalanche Express, which they finished without him. And that was the following year. So I think he only had about another year before he died. So,
was that his last film? Avalanche Express.
Wow. Avalanche Express was his last one, yes. And so that was either year or two after Force 10. But yeah, it's and I think isn't that the first one Alistair MacLean wrote the movie, then did the book? Because normally his movies were adaptations of books. But I think this one, didn't he write the film first?
Wait a minute, didn't he write the Guns of Navarone?
He did Guns of Navarone. He did Where Eagles Dare. He did the
novels. He wrote the novels, but he was more more of a consultation in the screenwriting. I mean, like he gave it its blessing, right? It was more Robin. In Carl Foreman. So I believe he wrote the book. Sorry.
I know he did the book, but I thought the book may have come out after the movie. But yeah, no, it's 4-10 from Navarone. It's a classic. It's crap. So I'm only speeding things up a bit because we've been at it 2.5 hours and I've been having a laugh, but it's anyway, it's my turn to do my movies, then we can all go. Yes,
sure. Have we beaten the Normandy live stream for
we
time?
Have, yeah, we've, well, no, I haven't beaten the Normandy one. Yeah, that was 15 hours, for Christ's sake. We're coming up that kind of level.
That was nice fun, too.
We're gonna do my movies now because we need to get to that point. So my absolute stinker, and it comes into very much like 4-10 from Navarone, because my absolute stinker is The Passage, which I'm sure some of you here have never even heard of. And The Passage was 1979, directed by J. Lee Thompson, who directed Ice Cold in Alex, Guns of Navarone, classic films, starring Anthony Quinn, James Mason, Christopher Lee, Malcolm McDowell, Michel Lonsdale, the French actor who died this week. And it should have been brilliant. And it absolutely wasn't. It was absolute stinking pile of crap, but best known among kind of cult film for this scene. And this scene is where Malcolm McDowell, as the Nazi Gestapo guy chasing the goodies, tortures Michel Lonsdale, who had been Moonraker the same year. He was Moonraker and the villain in that. And using a chopping knife and a chopping board, he Michel Lonsdale ends up losing his pinkies there. It's a really horrific scene. And there's a great quote I researched for it. This is what Malcolm McDowell said. He said, "I was determined to have some fun with it. My attitude was that if I was going to play a Nazi, I was going to take it totally over the top and do it right. I ended up playing the character like a pantomime queen. What I was doing was so far out that James Mason turned to me one day and said, 'That's wonderful, dear boy, but are you in our film? You seem to be doing something different from the rest of us.'" Which is really sums it up, because Malcolm McDowell, who was drinking heavily at the time, just plays it like this outrageous, campy, spoof comic book villain. Yeah, Anthony Quinn is playing it absolutely straight. He's playing it as if it's a sequel to Guns of Navarone. He's a Basque farmer who has to escape, get a scientist played by James Mason out of occupied Nazi Europe into Spain, and he has to guide him over the Alps, and it ends up with the same avalanche you see on Her Majesty's Secret Service. And it's just awful. And it should be so much better with the director and the cast. Christopher Lee is a gypsy in it who ends up getting tortured to death. And it had, they filmed three endings for the movie, right? And they obviously couldn't decide which one to use, so they used all three. Honestly, watch The Passage, because it has three separate endings. Like, we can't decide. We'll just do one after the other and let the audience get completely confused. It is insanely weird.
Can I just ask you something? Your man who was getting his fingers cut off.
Yeah.
Is that the inspector from Day of the Jackal?
Yeah. It is. Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. 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 Michel Lonsdale. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm terrible with names.
He's also been in great, 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 great classics by Buñuel.
He's been some amazing, you know, he's an absolute classic.
Has he got an iron cross on his apron?
He has, yeah. And at one point there's a, and I'm going to use the expression comedy rape in a way that it shouldn't really be used, but there is a comedy rape where it's played for laughs as the rape of the daughter of the scientist. Now, I'm not saying rape is funny, but that's how the movie does it. It gets the tone all wrong. And he's got the scientist's daughter like strapped to a bed, and he takes off his uniform and he's got swastikas on his jock strap. and I think the audience is meant to find it funny, and it's like, and then he puts his comb up over his, and he does a Hitler, and it's like the tone is just, honestly, you folks, if there's anybody still watching this, watch Passage. because it
was this made before or after the producers?
Oh, well after the producers, 1979.
No, they got the kind of springtime for Hitler.
Yeah, no, it is. It only came out on DVD and Blu-ray about 3 or 4 years ago. And I rushed to get a copy because I'd never seen it. And I watched it a couple of times trying to find something in it. Because, as I say, with Christopher Lee, James Mason, Anthony Quinn, it should be really good. And yet it's just unremittingly bad. And then there's one bit towards the end where for about 15 minutes, I don't know what they happened to the film stock, but the whole film is all wonky, where it's like a fisheye, where some guy had the wrong lens on the camera or something, and everybody's... It's just dreadful, absolutely dreadful. J. Lee Thompson, the director, never got a big film after that. That was it. But honestly, for those watching, The Passage, 1979, the only good thing about it is the score. The score was done by, I forget who it was, Elmer Bernstein or someone. The score is really good. And there's some nice mountain photography, but other than that, it's just general. Just dreadful, dreadful, dreadful. So that's The Passage. That's my first choice. And then kind of to wrap things up, and I think it's an excellent way to end this show, my classic film that is a crap film, but I love it, is, of course, The Wild Geese. I mean, you cannot get a better crap war film. I mean,
Richard Burton was ancient in that thing. He
was 903 when he made it. And and looked every one of those 903 years. The berets were clearly issued that morning. And no one's made any attempt to do anything with them to make them look. I mean, there's another one of Roger Moore here. And Duncan. And
doesn't he have a sapper Burton?
Burton's got Welsh Fusiliers, I think. I don't know what Roger Moore was meant to be.
The Irish Guards.
I think it's Irish Guards, yeah.
Looks like Metropolitan Police badge.
how long would you last wearing a beret like that, Duncan?
You wouldn't.
Yeah.
You wouldn't get out the quartermaster's compound wearing a beret like that, believe you, mate.
I mean, it is...
At least the badge is in the right place.
It isn't, yeah, it's in the right place, yeah. But I mean, so that had to be my choice. And I surprised Duncan by telling Duncan that I absolutely watch The Wild Geese at least once or twice every year without fail. I know every word. I love it. It annoys me because it's so bad, but it's so bad. I just love it. I love the music. I love the... And in serious, I'll let you guys defend it or assault it, but I was talking to one of you, I forget who it was. Interestingly, can you think of any other war film that has an openly gay character before The Wild Geese? Because Witty the Medic, he's gay in a Larry Grayson stereotype kind of Liberace way, but he is gay. Can you think of any war film with an openly gay character before The Wild Geese? Anyone here?
No.
How about anyone online?
Yes. There's one I saw. It was a Anglo-Franco movie starring, for heaven's sake, the British performance art and also comedian. He comes out in drag all the time. Or not drag.
Danny LaRue?
Sorry?
Danny LaRue? No.
Might be. Oh, hell. I'm forgetting everything. But it was, and that was a bad one. That was a stinker.
I always thought that Schultz. Schultz was the German in Kelly's Hero. Is it Kelly's? What was the one? Schultz.
Hogan's Heroes.
Hogan's Heroes. I thought that German was gay.
Yeah, but that's a TV series, not a movie.
But was he meant to be gay or did he? I don't know. Was that character meant to be gay? I can't remember Hogan's Heroes.
Colonel Klink? No.
That's it. Yeah.
Was he meant to be gay?
No.
No, I don't remember that.
Awkward. He was just loose. You know how those boys are.
But I mean, Witty the Medic. I mean, you couldn't make a film with the guy, the medic, giving the lines he gives now, you know. But for 1978, to have an openly gay character, albeit a cliched, awful one, it was quite groundbreaking. And also, treatment of racism. I mean, they do try the two South African actors, Winston Nichona and John Carney, who are both incredibly well known Shakespearean South African actors who play the only two black characters who have lines. They were incredibly, as I say, famous South African actors, and they do bring up some serious issues about race and Africa and working together. And so there is some serious undertones to The Wild Geese, but at the same time, you watch it, the weapons handling that is just awful, isn't it? Richard Burton has to look down every time he uses the Uzi. And the other guys are the same. And some of the guys playing the mercenaries are like 70 and they're running. And it's just, yeah. Can anyone say anything good about it?
When was Wild Geese made?
77.
78. When was Cross of Iron made?
76.
Because there's an openly gay character in Cross of Iron.
Oh, there is, Tree isn't Big. There? Yes.
Tree Big.
Tree Big is gay, isn't he?
Yeah.
So that's two. That we've come up with two, which is...
There's a good book. I have a friend of mine who's homosexual, and he's writing a queer book on the way homosexuals are depicted in action films and war films and westerns and stuff like that. And he was telling me that what was really interesting is that they're safe if they're really fey.
Yeah.
You know? The problem is when they're butch, you know, because I've never forgot this. You know, I've known him for 20 years. He says, look, a man wants a man. When a man wants a man, he's homosexual. He's still a man, you know?
Yeah,
I hope I'm not offending anyone.
No, you're not offending me.
But that, when heterosexual males see someone who's, well, what's going on here? Well, what are you? I mean, if you're fey, you're flippant, you're a good laugh, you know, it's you're funny, you're passable, you're cute, you're socially, there's a place for you, even if it marginalizes, a place for you, you know. But if you're a marine, if you're a leatherneck in Iwo Jima, you know, and you're like that, that's inexcusable, and that's where it gets ugly. And I think that argument, and he runs that argument throughout, you know, popular entertainment, whether TV or film and stuff like that. So I mean, just to dovetail on what you're saying, you know,
I mean, there's lots of war films where people have said now that the characters have gay undertones, that they were like in Ben-Hur. I know that's not a war film, but Stephen Boyd played it as if he was in love with Charlton Heston, but no one told Charlton Heston. So people say that there's a whole gay subtext going on that wasn't...
Tony Curtis and Spartacus.
That's right. Tony Curtis and Spartacus. Yeah.
Do you like
oysters?
Or snails? Yeah. But more importantly, look at my commando knife. 1943. Sorry.
I think... Does everyone know the link between two of our films tonight? Besides all being crap.
Go on.
The chap who directed The Wild Geese, Mr. Andrew McLaughlin, he also directed Return from the River Kwai.
He did, and he was Victor McLaughlin's son, wasn't he?
Yep, he was.
Who was Treasure of Sierra Madre and lots of films with the Duke.
He also directed The Sea Wolves, which was on my shortlist for...
The Sea Wolf, which is kind of the Wild Geese remade,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah.
It's half the same cast. And the Seawolves, that's another true story. I've got the book. The Seawolves was based on the Calcutta Light Horse, the raid into Portuguese
Goa,
wasn't it? It was the raid into Goa to knock out a German signal ship.
Roger Moore in that one.
Yeah, Roger Moore, Gregory Peck, Trevor Howard,
Jesus, David Evan again. About a million years old.
And Kenneth Griffith is in it as well, playing not a gay character this time, although he could be. But yeah, so the Wild Geese. Anyone else got any? We all of a similar age here. Adam, you must have memories of watching the Wild Geese on a Friday night coming back from the pub. Surely that was an Australian classic as well.
No, what I remember the most, I guess, it was probably Saturday afternoons, was Von Ryan's Express.
That was always on.
And then, you know, a whole bunch of movies where I'm not allowed to say the names of. But yeah, Von Ryan's Express was a regular here growing up, you know, 10, 11, 15, that sort of age.
Kelly's Heroes, once a month. Yep.
Can't go wrong. Yep. We're into good movies now, which we'll do. Perhaps we'll do a second show about good movies at some point. But in terms of bad movies, is there any crappy movies that haven't been mentioned tonight that we should just mention briefly before we switch off? And I mean, I said in my things on Twitter, there are movies that are divisive, things like 1917, Dunkirk, that some people like and some people don't. But I don't think they can be counted as crappy movies because they have merit. But there are some movies like Five for Hell, Adams, that is absolutely just a crap movie. There's no other way of describing it as a crap movie. Return from the River Kwai is just a crap movie. Any other candidates we should have mentioned tonight?
I've got a crap movie. I can't.
Breakthrough. Oh my God, yes.
Breakthrough.
Run us through what Breakthrough was, Neil.
Well, Breakthrough is the sequel to Cross of Iron, isn't it? They're using the same character names. And I think only one of the original actors is in it. I can't remember the guy who played
it. The sergeant who doesn't wash, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it. Oh, God, it's just dreadful. It's the kind of movie you watch it and you're just praying for a stroke. Because it's just, Richard Burton is just, you just can't buy it. You know, James Coburn is always going to be Steiner, isn't he? And no matter what's kind of wrong with Cross of Iron, and most of it's the Bulgarian helmets being used as Russian, but it's still a watchable movie. It's still a great movie.
More than watchable.
You get pulled in with the characters, but Breakthrough, it's just a
Breakthrough should be good because it's Richard Burton, Robert Mitchum, Kurt Jurgens, Rod Steiger, Helmut, the guy playing the German, because the Maximilian Schell is in it again, but not the same actor again. It's the same German, Stransky.
But
it's played by someone else, isn't it?
Yeah, I think I've been able to watch it all the way through once.
And that's a Breakthrough is a West German film, so it's all West German camo, isn't it? Is that right?
Yeah, that's it.
And DPM and stuff. Yeah, it's dreadful. If anyone watching it, there's a few people left. Some have fucked off to the pub, and I don't blame them at all. There are a few left. Breakthrough is definitely worth watching. Just as to do, Chad, you watch Breakthrough going all the way through. If a war film makes you go that all the way through, it's dreadful. If you go, oh no, oh. And there were so many. I couldn't find any stills of it. And I'm not even going to mention, I wasn't going to mention it because it's so hard to get. Is a 1970s TV movie called The Secret War of Jackie's Girls, which basically.
Oh, they had helicopters.
Yeah, I'll get that. You know it, Adam. Jeez, you are the only other living human being apart from the cast who's aware. It basically takes Charlie's Angels and mixes it with the Battle of Britain with. Because they have these helicopters in Kent that's clearly California. You know the bit in Austin Powers when Austin Powers pulls over and goes, isn't it amazing how much California looks like Southern England? and they go in these helicopters without cockpits in 1943 and they rescue people from occupied Nazi Europe and take them to a Cockney pub that's obviously some studio in Burbank. No, honestly, if you can find it, The Secret War of Jackie's Girls is. I mean, Adam, what do you remember of it, Adam? Because you're the only other person who knows it.
I can remember the title, but also they used to trick the Mississippis into flying into cliffs all the time.
Yes, that's right. Yes, the fast-moving helicopters managed to outmaneuver the Messerschmitts and make them jump in to all those cliffs that we know exist in rural France. However I'm describing it, it is not. It's worse than I'm describing it. It is just terrible. I mean, The Secret War of Jackie's Girls is. You can't imagine how they even got it off the ground. I mean, but yeah, the Wild Geese. I mean, I will never not. What, Duncan, bring you in as this. Well, that must have been a squaddy classic, the Wild Geese, surely.
It was, yeah. Without a shadow of a doubt, yeah, it was the movie. I remember going up to the SKC cinema in Purbright on a Wednesday night with £10 in my pocket, you know, buying a load of ice cream and sitting there and watching that. And everyone jeered all the way through it. We had to go the following week and watch it again. It was absolutely superb. I love it. I love it.
Just while I've got an audience, although I love the Wild Geese, the scene that really gets on my tits is when they're about to cross the bridge with the dry river and the Bedford RL gets blown up on the bridge and the guy dies and Roger Moore does the "It's something horrible way to die" kind of crack. And Richard Burton, the president they're trying to rescue, Lynn Barney, Hardy Kruger and a couple of guys who are going to get killed quickly. They're like the Star Trek guys in the red tunics are on the other side. They're on the other. They're still on the dangerous side of the bridge. But for some reason, they can't just walk down across the dry river and join Richard Harris's group. They have to drive. I've never understood the logic of that. I don't understand why they don't go. It's just a dry riverbed. Just climb down there, mate. Carry the stretcher. You're with us. But no, they have to drive down into the village. And then they meet Frank Finlay, who's in a completely different film. He's playing it like it's a kind of a... what's that? Catherine, he's playing it like a Catherine Cookson kind of working class Irish drama of the streets of Dublin. You know, you and your filthy heathens. He's in a different movie completely. And then the machine gun bit, I'm ranting now. When they set up the Vickers on the corner of the airfield, and you think, you know, when I was seven, I could, with my Britain's figures, I could plan a better withdrawal to the aircraft than Richard Burton, a colonel, could. You know, I'm going, at six, I knew that was shit, you know? And and yet these supposedly expert mercenaries who between them have served in numerous world wars and they're all special forces, they do this city kind of, you put the machine gun there, we'll run over here, and then the boy, the little boy, we can't go on without mentioning Richard Harris's son, Emil. Remember the bit?
Yeah.
Richard Burton goes to visit him and he goes, we're going on a skiing holiday, hooray, hooray. Oh, fuck off. Just, he should have been taken on the mission and he should have been left to the Simbas, that kid. That kid did not deserve to live. I'm sorry, but he was just a little prick. And why Richard Harris wanted him to be saved, sorry, I'm ranting now. I've had too much beer.
I remember the actor, Eddie Izzard.
Eddie Izzard?
Eddie Izzard.
He wasn't in the Wild Geese.
No. No, he was in this commando movie. There were women.
No, the cross. With Matt LeBlanc from Friends.
All the Queen's Men.
Matt knows it. Oh, there we go.
Yep. Sorry about that. I did. I think I actually paid money to see that.
And James Cosmo from Battle of Britain is in it, isn't he? Well.
Very bad. Very bad.
That's a very bad film.
I've been having a look at the chat, and U571's been coming up a lot.
Oh, that's...
Oh, we should mention that, shouldn't we?
I have a very controversial opinion on this one.
You like it?
No, it's shit.
But
I read, just before he died, I read an interview with David Baum, who's the sub-lantern who went into U110 to get the Enigma. Mm. And he was the historical advisor on 571.
So,
and his reasoning for it was, well, you can't complain about it because no one wanted to make the movie right and the Americans wanted to tell the story. So I helped them to tell the story as best as they could, even though they made it their own.
Well, that is true, yeah.
And you sort of go, well, you were the guy.
Yeah, but so, you know, that's a responsibility because there are a bunch of kids who actually believe that.
Yeah. No. Well, the thing is, David Ayer wrote it, apologized for appropriating history, and then made Fury.
Actually, on Twitter earlier, I think the director of photography, Steve something, commented, and he wants to come on World War II TV and talk about Fury. So he was on it. Yeah, and he said, everyone says the ending was shit. I said, well, I wanted to go, well, everyone said the ending was shit because the ending was shit. I mean, there's no, you can't polish a turd, can you? I mean, Fury, the end of Fury is shit, isn't it? You know, you can't polish a turd, but you can. But
most of Fury.
What, sorry?
It was an important crossroads, you know? They had to hold it. It was a strategic, you know, point in the battle. You know, if that tank wasn't there, you know, on that crossroads, you know, I mean, there was no way those SS soldiers were going to walk around through a muddy field.
I was waiting for some little pearl of wisdom to come out there. Because that was set in 45. They must have been the only German division that didn't have a fucking Panzerfaust for a 45, didn't they? I mean,
that's the one thing
they're producing shitloads of.
Yeah.
And by the way, didn't SS divisions have an artillery component to them? Didn't they have an...
Yeah, they had these things called anti-tank guns, you know, that they were generally used.
That's the thing, isn't it? They've got an anti-tank gun crew. You can see that they've got kill rings on the bloody barrel, and yet three shots, they can't hit point-blank Sherman.
But 17 feet away, yeah.
Hang on a minute. I'm sure they would have known how to use a gun. They've got 9 kills on the bloody barrel. Fury's
The bit in Fury that it actually annoys me the most isn't actually the bit with the tanks. It's the bit when they just storm into that family's house.
Yeah.
That is the creepiest shit ever. You know, that whole scene with them sitting around making them dinner, taking the daughter off. You're just sitting there thinking, yeah, I know this is... How did this get past the edit? You know, that is...
But I'm assuming the Brad Pitt taking his shirt off is the female viewer's equivalent of us watching Stephanie Powers and Escape to Athena, isn't it? That's the payback. Yes. That's our punishment for watching war movies with token women, is that Brad Pitt, who was 50 when he made that, who looks better at 50 than I did when I was 21, takes his shirt off, and women went, oh, that was a good bit. Just like we...
Chaz is better at 50 than you do with 21.
Yeah, whatever.
Well, Chaz has been in funding meetings. I'm sure there's like, right, well, we've got Brad Pitt. I'll give you $25 million. Great. Does he take his shirt off? Yes, right. You've got 35.
Yeah. You know. Can we make him take his shirt off in the script? Yes, we'll do. Yeah.
Can I just say two things about Fury? I'm not defending the movie because I thought it was absolutely honking. But what Fury does do is A, it shows how shit it was to be in a tank.
Yes.
And B, it really does show the brutality of war. And that is the only two plus points that comes out of the movie Fury.
You're referring to that first battle, which is pretty good when they come in on force with the kid, the machine gunner, is forced to use a revolver on the.
The first bit is good. Yeah.
I
must say it's a good
movie. By the way, what revolver is that? Because why is it a Colt? Was that a Webley? What? It was a revolver.
He's got a Smith & Wesson 38, I think, isn't he?
Is that what it is? Okay.
Yeah. They wanted to give him something cool. And
but he was too thin to hold a Webley. He would have fell over.
Yeah, if it was a 4.55 Webley, yeah. I mean, I heard that they when they were conceiving Fury, you can have the guy on, he can talk about it. They were considering it basing on that real known event in Normandy where von Tyson, who Mark Bando wrote about in Breakout in Normandy, the German officer, ended up in like a 3 or 4 day duel with an American officer in 3rd Armored, if I'm remembering correctly, or 2nd Armored. And it was a real story. And they were thinking of developing that idea. Then they ended up chickening out and putting fictitious characters in because they couldn't do with real characters what you can do with fictitious characters. And that's why they kind of ditched, which is another discussion for another day. And it's much easier to make a movie about people who are completely fictitious because you can do what you want with them. Start telling about real people. Like if they remake the Dam Busters, which they're supposed to be, Guy Gibson, for all his heroism, was a bit of a jerk, wasn't he? I mean, he wasn't a likable person. Are we in agreement on that, Matt, really, generally?
Oh, yeah.
And Philip?
Yeah. Is that remake with the dog or without the dog?
Yeah, well, that's another discussion. But Guy Gibson was a bit of a like Douglas Bader. If they ever remade Reach for the Sky, I mean, I've told some of you this. I met Douglas Bader. I was 10 years old ish. I was at an air show in England. Douglas Bader, for those watching, if you don't know, we've been a bit self indulgent and talking about stuff. You hopefully those are watching haven't been completely alienated by it. But Douglas Bader, the RAF pilot, lost his legs in the 1930s, went to command the big wing flying out of Duxford. I met him at an air show. I was 10 years old. He was in a VIP tent. I had my copy. I knew he could be at the air show. I had a copy of a book he wrote, and my dad blagged me into the VIP tent. We asked the security guard, can my son go in and say hello to Mr. Bader? And he wasn't doing anything. He wasn't in the middle of a dinner. He was standing by the tent watching the air show. And I went in very politely with my book, and I said, Mr. Bader, you're a hero of mine. I've seen the movie and I've read your books. Would you sign my book? And he said to me, oh, bugger off, you horrible little child. And that is my encounter with Douglas Bader.
Wow.
My uncle worked with
him. And I'm sorry, that ruined a bit of my childhood. And now I watch Reach for the Sky. I can't help it. And I wrote to Muriel Pavlo, who played his wife in the movie. And she wrote back, she's passed away now, and said how terrified she was when the real Douglas Bader came to the set because he would just shout at everybody. So if you're talking about real characters, can you tell it warts and all? I mean, Philip raised his finger there. So
wasn't he? Philip,
I was going to say, the thing that put me off with Douglas Bader is when I read Rudel's memoirs.
Who's Batman?
The foreword was written by Douglas Bader.
Oh, right.
And Rudel had obviously, the Stuka pilot, had made himself a supporter of this alternative German society in South America.
Right.
And there's Bader writing the foreword. Staggered.
Well, yeah, so...
Another one that's sort of on the Bader level, which, you know, you would... you sort of not think about it, is Roger Bushell, made famous in The Great Escape. Who played him in The Great Escape? It was Attenborough that was Bushell in Great Escape, wasn't he? You read about him in 19 Squadron. Was it Jeff Wellham's book? He was not a nice chap. You watch The Great Escape and you think it's all jolly holly sticks and he was the chap, but yeah, Bushell was not a nice bloke, you know, and with Gibson, you know, he just finished two tours, was, you know, mentally shot, and then was asked to form an entire squadron and go off. He was not in any mental state, to lead that. The fact that he probably was an asshole as well didn't help.
So I think
we also have to remember
we end up going into other conversations here. So as we're coming up to 3 hours, which seems ridiculous, but it has been, I think we should kind of draw it to an end and let people go back to reality and stop this. But I'll be interested to know what the viewing figures are after this. I've been watching the concurrent viewers, but it doesn't give me an accurate idea. We've lost a few, gained a few. The conversations have died off a bit, either because they're bored or they're absolutely fascinated with what we're talking about, or both. I don't know. But it's been interesting. And I think it does, you know, this NAAFI Natters format, I think, has some legs. We can discuss some other things, serious war films or other things to do with World War II. But I think we'll bring it to an end now because it's been ridiculously long. And are you going to go back to bed, Adam? Had some kids? Are you going to be up now? Are you going to stay up now, Adam?
That's at 7 o'clock. The day
so
started.
It's getting up time now. So,
I've got ribs on the grill and it's going to burn.
Okay. So, Chaz, Chaz, Duncan, David, Adam, Neil, Matt, Phil, me, it's been an interesting discussion. If you've enjoyed it in any way at all, then that's been good. We've discussed some war films. So, for those watching, in terms of World War II TV, we've got a show from Sunday afternoon. We're talking about B-17s flying out of Essex. There's some serious stuff. And then we've got other things coming up next month. But I'm a bit tired now because I've had a few beers as well. So we'll say goodnight, folks. And thank everybody for attending. And we'll see you again. And thank you to my guests for joining in. It's been fun. I've enjoyed it. So goodbye, everybody. Thank you very much. Cheers.
Bye.
See you later. Have a good day.
Pleasure to meet everybody.
Right. So that's it. I've ended the stream now. So you can-